Mentor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Bushido Online, Pacchi Festival, by Nikita Thorn, narrated by Christian Rummel. Prologue. The door to the small apartment slid open with a gentle buzz, letting a wave of the slightly warmer air from the interior escape through the entrance. In the doorway stood a young man dressed in a casual dark blue t-shirt and jeans, whose initial expectant look was perhaps a little too eager for the occasion of a random visitor. Tom smiled.
Morning, Seth. Hope this isn't a bad time. I sent you a message about 15 minutes ago, but it wasn't read, so I thought you were logged in.
Hi. The young host's enthusiasm turned into surprise as he figured out the identity of his guest.
Tom?
Okay, come in. He stepped aside to make way for his former coach.
My phone was charging, and I must have been in the shower. I didn't think you were going to be back till next week.
It turned out they expected me to be physically there at least 3 days a week, even when I clearly said in the call I wasn't willing to do that. So it was a very quick interview. Tom cast a quick glance at the interior of the room, pausing to look at a plastic box half tucked under the bed.
Are you in the middle of something?
I'm tidying up a little, said Seth.
So they were trying to rope you in, huh?
Sorry it didn't work out.
I could have said so earlier and saved me 4 hours of driving.
Tom chuckled as he walked over to the side cabinet, tapping the document bundle against the wood surface to show its location before setting it down.
Anyway, I got the things you need to sign for the car. It's quite a bit to go through. I'll leave the folder here, all right?
Oh, thanks, said Seth. I'll need to go into the office and get their scanner, and they don't open till Monday. He sounded a little distracted, as if he had more important matters on his mind at the moment.
Take your time.
Tom paused to glance around some more. Apart from the box the young man appeared to be wrestling with, the room was in a neater state than usual. On the small pantry were two ceramic cups set side by side. Next to it was a kettle, which was already boiling and filling the corner with thick, warm vapor. Laid out behind the set was also an unopened box of fruit tea. Lifting his eyebrow, Tom squinted to read the upside-down label, which said Premium Red Berries Infusion. He walked over to the table by the window to set down a paper bag he was carrying and stole a quick look at Seth, who was crouching down to tuck the storage box under his bedside table.
Expecting someone?
Yeah, Lindsay's dropping by with some patch updates. Seth then perked up as he heard the sound of Tom's paper bag clanging on the table, a grin on his face.
Please tell me you got me beer. These are all from your mom, said Tom. And since when did they let you drink?
The young man apparently decided not to venture into the subject.
All right, more pasta and corn soup.
He laughed as he dragged another storage box out from under his bed, felt for the label, and decided to cram more unwanted stuff in it.
I didn't know you were going home.
Yeah, the registration was back at your folks's.
Tom slowly sorted the contents of the paper bag into neat piles on the table.
Your mom said something about how you're looking to move back there after the program.
At the lack of an immediate answer, Tom glanced back to check the young man's expression. Seth was grimacing.
Well, not exactly. I told her I would think about it. I've still got more than a year left, so it's not like I've got to decide right now.
You'll be closer to family, said Tom, and most of your friends are still back there.
Yeah.
The young man let out a sigh.
So what? I can say, yo, come over tonight and watch football?
He chuckled grimly.
You know, Tom, it's not like I'm on my own out here. I've got friends online.
Your game friends?
Yeah.
And they're real people?
At least some of them.
A brief silence followed, and Seth added,
All right, that was a joke. Don't worry, Tom. I can tell the difference. If you try the game, you'll know what I mean. It's realistic, but it's not like...
He bit his lip.
Well, never mind.
Tom took a long breath as if to say something, but then decided against it.
And Lindsay. You mean that lady Lindsay Miles from Verco's customer service?
The question seemed to lift the young man's mood.
Yes, the one you gave your spare key to so she could come drag me out of bed?
Said Seth in mock accusation, although he made no effort to hide the eagerness in his tone.
Her job's more like hardware calibration, so she comes in every other week or so to check the equipment and install updates to make sure the, what are they called? The neural interpreters and some other interpreters are up to date, especially with this upcoming patch.
Oh, that's nice.
Yeah, it's great to talk to someone who knows what it's all about and I guess doesn't think this is a huge waste of time.
Seth, I don't think it's a waste of time. It's just, well, we've talked about this before.
Yeah, I know, and I get where you're coming from. It's not real. It's a fantasy. Yeah, it's true, but there's... things are just... I don't know, things are normal in there somehow. When I told people that this accident happened and the doctor said the chances are slim that I will ever be able to see again, you know what their answer was? Oh, damn, I'm sorry, that really sucks. And then they looked at me and said, well, wanna go grind some River Kappa for XP now?
I'm not sure I follow.
Yeah, that's kind of my point, you see?
He shook his head.
Out here,
you have a date.
That caught the young man off guard and he nearly choked.
What? It's not...
Oh, she's a fine girl, Tom interrupted casually. Much prettier than those gold-digging groupies who used to trail you around. No plastic. Well, either that or really, really good plastic. You know what they can do now.
Seth opened his mouth but failed to come up with a protest as he was perhaps suddenly confronted with prospects of the future he was not ready for and things he could not yet trust himself to judge. Still, it took him only a second to recover.
The least I can do is give her something nice to drink while we wait for the update to finish. She said it's going to take a while since it's an important patch. It's common courtesy.
No ring that I noticed, continued Tom. That was a few months ago, but I can stay to check again.
A horrified look washed over Seth's face before he finally broke into a laugh.
Okay, I know you're grinning over there, Tom. But no, I'm not gonna blush, and this is none of your business.
He waved his hand as he pushed the last storage box under the bed, trying hard not to smile.
Please just go away before she gets here. I've got a festival to get to.
Chapter 1. The glass wind chime sounded from outside the windows of the fourth floor room, two bright, high-pitched notes ringing clear above the constant clamor rising from the city below. Glancing up from the pile of loot he was arranging, Seiki recognized the familiar shape of the incoming post pigeon on the window, and he quickly leapt to his feet to admit the bird before it could start flapping against the paper screen. Since its official start about 18 hours ago, the Pacchi Festival had raised Shinshioka's level of noise to a new standard. While the soundproofing shoji panels around the private territory could muffle the ruckus to an inconspicuous hum, it was an all-or-nothing enchantment effect. As soon as Seiki cracked the window open, the sounds from the ongoing festival flooded into the room, increasing the overall volume by at least another 20 decibels. Widening the gap to let the gray pigeon land on the windowsill, Seiki detached the message and let the bird fly back out over the festival crowd. Despite having spent much of that afternoon gazing out his window, the sight of the vibrant festival still caught him by surprise and he decided to slide open the window all the way for the full view. The Pacchi Festival had transformed Shinshioka into a large tapestry of moving colors. Seiki's newest private territory gave him an elevated vantage point over Trade Street and the green-roofed Mani Shrine, although neither landmark was recognizable under the current layer of festival decorations. Yellow and black flags, symbolizing the Rogami clan, lined the majority of roof edges, creating crisscrossing patterns across the whole city, like spines of intertwining dragons that heaved in the strong afternoon wind. Filling the spaces between the yellow outlines were cloth banners, some yellow, some black and white, some crimson and gold, hanging from shops and public walls. Shrine gates were decorated with dyed shiminawa ropes and strings of paper lamps, which Seiki was looking forward to seeing once they lit up at night. In the streets, patches of Shinshioka's original red and black motif marked signposts and guard stations, visible amidst rows of vendor stalls that had magically popped up over the course of a few hours. Between the temporary structures, people flowed through the streets in a stream of multicolored specks. Seiki still found it difficult to believe this was the same city he had come to know so well. The familiar sounds of passing conversations, horse hooves, and occasional brawls had been completely replaced by a symphony of novel noises from a thousand different activities. The crowds in the streets were constantly buzzing, with time-limited items being bargained for, traded, packed, unpacked, mixed in with a good many excited exclamations from players who had just discovered something new. Occasionally, through a sporadic lapse in the hollering from street vendors, a random phrase of music would lift from one of the frequent city parades, sometimes a soaring melody from a bamboo flute, sometimes the lively rhythmic beating of drums, clear against a backdrop of distant bells from the city's numerous temples. On a different plane of senses, the constant cool wind that blew through Shinshioka now carried with it a rich, complicated aroma. It was mostly the appetizing smell of food, both sweet and savory, the strongest right now being that of deep-fried dough from the street stalls right outside his window. But beyond that, Seiki also noticed faint incense and lamp oil, and perhaps even firecrackers. Seiki had briefly been at the stalls earlier, and he had been utterly fascinated by the range of products on offer, which included everything from consumables to traditional wooden toys to art prints and territory furniture. Most of them were probably there as fillers, like 20 different versions of decorative vases that did nothing special, but the sheer volume and variety were still impressive. Seiki let out a long, satisfied sigh. It had been the Rogami clan that had triggered the event, and as annoying as it was, he could not find a reason to gripe. The festival had brought about a kind of bustle he had never seen before, even in Shinshioka's peak hours, and it made him feel intensely awake and alive, a feeling he always craved. He finally turned his attention back to the message and read it aloud to Ipe across the room.
Yamura's coming right now, and he asked how long the meeting would take since he's in the middle of... something long and important. He didn't say what.
Ipe, level 15, looked up from the tea table where he had been working on his own series of correspondence.
10-15 minutes, if people are efficient. But that depends on how reasonable the white cranes are with the negotiations.
He nodded toward the pile of loot from the Shussebora Cave, which Seiki had been arranging in the middle of the room.
Quite a few attractive pieces in there, and at the very least, they're worth a lot of gold.
Okay, 15 minutes, but most likely longer then, said Seiki as he wrote a quick reply to Yamura. I'll ask him what he wants from the pile, and we can maybe negotiate for him if he can't make it.
Normal loot division etiquette gave the instance owner full rights to distribute the spoils. Last night's case, however, was a little more complicated. It had been the White Crane Order's treasure poem that had led to a treasure hidden within Seiki's personal instance, but then it had been Kentaro who had finally ended up with the mysterious level 32 tailoring recipe, so afterward no one was sure what was fair.
To be honest, I'm happy for them to take almost everything, said Seiki.
Now that he had turned his attention back to it, he still could not quite believe it had been less than 24 hours since they discovered the hidden cave and the treasure. The festival seemed to overshadow even that. Ipe laughed.
Do you want to just tell them that and call off the meeting? I know you're dying to go explore.
Seiki chuckled but made a face.
Let's do this properly.
This was his first official loot division meeting and he somehow felt responsible for it. The loot pile consisted of a total of 7 enhancement scrolls, which equaled the exact number of players present in the Shussebora instance, and this made it pretty clear who they were meant for. Of the 2 that dropped for sword classes, one offered rather significant reduction of energy cost for focused strike, while the other allowed a free first parry in 3 minutes. Ipe seemed to be on the fence about both.
Nice, but not essential, the samurai had said.
There was also an additional modification scroll for the ronin class. Seiki had studied the description so many times he had almost memorized the exact wording.
Ability modification scroll. Debilitating slash. Upslash no longer has a wind effect, but instead, upon connection, applies a disarm with an added 2-second stun on up to 3 targets. Read the scroll aloud in the swordsman shrine to apply the enhancement.
Modification scrolls, like what the label suggested, changed the way a standard ability worked. This was the first decent modification scroll Seiki had seen, and it had the potential to be extremely powerful, especially in close combat. Still, it meant he would have to sacrifice the anti-projectile effect of the move. Seiki had been pondering this one for a while. Being so used to how upslash worked, he wondered if he really wanted such a drastic change to his toolkit. Should he choose to apply it, it would also take one of his enhancement slots, so he would need to decide whether he would rather give up the reduced energy cost for his slides or the 1-second extension on his vertical spike stun, both of which he had learned to rely on. Ipe had been surprised by his reservation.
Imagine this, the samurai had said. You're going to have a 1-second stun and a 2-second stun on multiple targets. Can't ask for anything better than that. And modified abilities don't translate to troop abilities, so your troops are still going to have the original upslash windshield.
I'm just going to have too many stuns, Seiki had answered.
Ipe had laughed at that.
You can never have too many stuns, considering we might have the Kano Castle to worry about now.
His friend was right, and stuns were especially precious in PvP, Seiki promised to think about it. Among the loot, there was also another non-combat free slot scroll, which gave players a 25% chance to double their honor rewards from military missions and war events. While this would definitely be useful if he ended up losing a lot of honor points from fighting Rogami Griefers out the West Gate, there was no reason to waste time considering it. He and all his friends knew exactly what was going to immediately go into his free slot once it unlocked at level 16. The majority of free slot scrolls had no class restrictions. Most people went for the popular disarm, the guaranteed wrist slash that would force your opponent to let go of whatever they were holding at the cost of temporarily parting with your dagger. Non-PvP players often went for quality of life abilities like caution, which alerted players to the presence of nearby monsters, or memory, which would create a mental guide trail to help players find their way back to any particular spot. Class-restricted free slot abilities were rarer, and of course, class-restricted free slot abilities from an unlabeled quest that led to a mysterious instance, like the one Seiki had received from the Shussebora, were practically unheard of. For the umpteenth time, Seiki retrieved the mysterious Shussebora scale from his pocket just to look at it. Shussebora Scale of the Protector grants the user the Protection of the Sea ability, which places a protective shield over a single target within 60 feet for 6 seconds, absorbing damage equal to up to 200% of the target's maximum health, but not exceeding 200% of the user's current health. Damage exceeding the absorbed amount transfers back onto the user after a 3-second delay if the user is within 60 feet of the target. Lockout, 3 minutes. Requires an open free slot. The smooth blue-green scale had a strange quality to it, a mix of wood, metal, and shell that made it seem completely otherworldly. Seiki's first free slot would become available as soon as his experience, now frustratingly close to the next level, finally hit the threshold, and he could not wait to see what the ability would actually do. Apart from the scrolls, they also received crafting materials of all kinds, fabrics, herbs, and high-quality wood blocks. 2 wood crafting recipes had also dropped, one for a 48-slot Uchino storage box, and one for a Bunraku Hyoshigi, a simple musical instrument consisting of 2 wood pieces, a treasure that could be turned in at the palace for favors. There were also equipment pieces, 2 daggers, a short wooden staff, and a pair of speed sandals. None of these offered Seiki any upgrades, and he doubted the white cranes, who were of much higher levels, would have any use for them. Last, in the front of the pile, was a heavy yellow cloth bag, which held a little more than 1,100 gold, half of which had once been Fumiya of the Kano Castle's pocket change. Seiki grimaced at the memory of fighting the Kano Castle ninja. Even when no one had explicitly said so, he had a feeling there was an understanding among the player base that unless you were looking for a special kind of trouble, you did not go against the most powerful clan outside the East Gate. The last campaign against Kano Castle had ended in total destruction for all their opponents. Renshiro's original clan, whose name Seiki could never remember, had been forced to dissolve, and the Fuoka army, that had come to their aid, ended up losing their territory in Fuoka. After what had happened in the Shussebora Cave, Seiki and his friends did not expect to be able to walk away with absolutely no consequences, yet so far no visible threat had materialized. "Well, let's hope Kano Castle is as busy with the festival as everyone else," Seiki said. "That will give us some time to prepare. Although, to be honest, I'm not sure how exactly we're going to prepare for that," he added, knowing they were missing at least 10 levels to have a fighting chance. "Yeah," Ipe agreed. "Or better yet, let's hope that by the end of this week, the Rogami will get so cocky that they decide to invade the Kano Castle. That would keep both of them occupied for a few months." "That's not going to happen, is it?"
"Probably not," the samurai chuckled. "This Sengoro guy probably isn't stupid. Considering he's kept a rather low profile all this time and surprised everyone with a level 30 sprint."
According to Ipe's sources, that had caused a bit of an upset in the upper realms of the high-level clan players, and Seiki secretly hoped that whatever went on in that sphere would keep people busy enough to overlook the little loot kerfuffle the night before. Still, they decided to be safe, and Ipe had shown up earlier with the glass wind chime, toy, for Seiki's new territory, which he had called a housewarming gift. It was one of the numerous territory upgrade items you could get for your private room, and was supposed to act as a doorbell and alert Seiki to the presence of whoever was trying to get into his territory.
"At least it gives you some warning when you're about to get murdered right in your own home," the samurai had said with a wry smile.
Private territories were supposed to be completely safe, but since no one could explain why the Kano Castle ninja had managed to get into Seiki's personal instance without being in his group, they thought every little bit of warning would help. Curiously, however, like most toys, the wind chime came with an unexpected glitch and considered post pigeons individual entities. So when a message arrived, a mysterious gust of wind would lift just in time to rattle the tiny bell and announce the bird. The toy now jingled again as another bird flew in through the open window and dropped itself into Seiki's hand. Yamura, level 17. 1 minute ago. Never mind, I'm coming. Where's this place again? Now I'm stuck on the other side of Mani Shrine and the roads are blocked and the NPCs don't know where South Funari is.
South Funari?
Seiki blinked at the mangled territory title. Every private territory in Shinshioka had an official name, but were often better known by their nicknames based on their most obvious feature, the pawn shop room at Central Crossing, or the unimaginative East Gate Room and West Gate Room for the two closest to the city's two main exits. Kintaro's fancy North City territory was famously known as the Koi Pond Room, one of the most aesthetically pleasing territories in the city. There was also a society room, a rather unassuming second-floor territory in the same building where the Shinshioka Scientific Society had made their headquarters. Seiki's newest territory was one of the few that bore no common name. Some called it the Mani Shrine Room, but that often indicated another territory slightly further east on the other side of the shrine in South City. On the territory deed, the room was named Furuhashi South, and although that particular term did not appear anywhere on the society's updated map of Shinshioka, NPC guards were usually able to point out the direction for players. Despite the territory's virtue of being decently priced and centrally located near the midway point of Trade Street, it required four flights of stairs to reach and was near nothing of immediate usefulness. Therefore, it was not all that popular, which was probably part of why Seiki had chosen it in the first place. Looking out the window once more, Seiki scanned the city for a more obvious landmark to add to the instructions. It was a surprisingly tough pick among the new landmarks that had popped up. The city had been busy with preparations the whole past week, with NPCs hanging up lamps and flags and engaging in little parades, but the scale of the real change once the festival officially started was beyond anyone's expectations. Even Ipe admitted it was much more impressive than the one held for the first crafter who reached max level in a trade skill. Every shop now boasted bright, bold signs that advertised special discounts and time-limited items. Several sections of Trade Street had been blocked out as pedestrian zones for specialty stalls. Overeager NPCs stood at street corners to hand out flyers and shout to potential customers. To add to the sense of realism, perhaps, the streets were annoyingly covered with discarded copies of these, which strangely did not immediately fade like other discarded messages. Processions came down the street every hour or so, much more elaborate than before, now featuring decorated floats of bright red lamps and various kami statues. Festival NPCs, either masked or with painted faces, sometimes in the hundreds, danced and clapped, shouting rhythmic oi in unison, filling the air with constant music and drum beats. And spectators crowded the streets to watch, while the rest of the traffic was diverted down different side streets in Shinshioka's complicated network of roads. Guessing that Yamura was probably caught in one of these, Seiki supplied the official territory name of Furuhashi South again, and added a note about the entrance being on the lane opposite a big red sign with a fish on it with a huge line of people. Seiki had been one of those in the line earlier, and the giant taiyaki, level 3 food, had been completely worth the 85 silver. It also gave him a useless buff that added 3% luck when fishing for 2 hours. Ending the note to Yamura with a minor endorsement of the taiyaki, he sent out the message. There was no way his friend could miss it now. Another pigeon arrived just as he sent one off. This time it was from Kentaro.
Are people going to show up or are we just going to do post correspondence? Muttered Ipe.
Seiki laughed as he unrolled Dohoshi's message.
Well, Kentaro says he doesn't want anything from the loot pile, so we can go ahead and start once the white cranes get here. Because apparently he's also doing something very important. Hopefully that something very important is finding a way to use the society's unique dagger, said Ipe.
The mysterious red headband master pattern recipe was level 32. Since all trade skills went up to a maximum of 30, it meant they would require the use of the unique dagger Needle of the Weaving Princess, which added +2 levels to any trade skill. There was another jingle from the wind chime. This time, a gray pigeon flew straight in past Seiki and landed noisily on the table where Ipe was sitting at.
Finally, said the samurai. The West Defenders. Hope they've come to their senses about having a kitsune.
Ipe had been discussing war games with the West Defenders all afternoon. The clan, like most PvE clans, had not been too thrilled to learn of Seiki's scuffle with the Rogami out the West Gate and the resulting out-of-line debuff. It would not affect their spectator run at the ruins of Hitsu Temple scheduled for a few days from now, but it might hurt Ipe's secret plan to have qualified West Defenders speed them through the remaining instances and catch up with the war front. Umiko of the West Defenders had told them straight up the clan had no interest in getting into clan conflicts of any sort, which Ipe thought was a little funny, considering they had tried to invade the Shinshioka Scientific Society before to steal one of their unique weapons.
Wait till they hear about Kano Castle, too!
Ipe had somehow found that extremely amusing. Seiki knew his friend was more concerned than he let on, and they had agreed that simply mentioning strategy for the ruins of Hitsu Temple was probably not going to be enough to keep the West Defenders convinced. They now needed to demonstrate it, and that itself also relied on the West Defenders being able to pull it off. As Ipe once again tried to explain the merits of having a kitsune in the group makeup via post, Seiki idly looked out the window. His eyes drifted towards the busy taiyaki stall.
I wonder what's taking Yamura so...
His breath caught. A ghastly white face was staring at him, a spot of eerie stillness in the moving crowd around it. It was a familiar sight. Its eyes were carved out hollow slits, its lips slightly parted in a permanent snarl. Long, straight black hair reached beyond its shoulders, falling over a long-sleeved blood-red kimono. Seiki fought down a shiver. It was directly under his window, looking straight up, paying no attention to the other festival-goers that flowed around it. No one paid it any attention either, and at the back of his mind, Seiki wondered if he was the only one who could see it. His eyes still fixed on the figure, he drew a slow, shallow breath.
No one can see in, right?
He said, more quietly than he intended.
Into this room?
Said Ipe.
No, unless they're in your group.
Right. Seiki found little comfort in that answer as he continued to stare. As if noticing that he had spotted it, the masked figure lifted its arms, raising its long, dark red sleeves, looking as if it was preparing to launch straight at the window. Despite being perfectly sure nothing could reach through territory boundaries, Seiki unconsciously let go of the windowsill to put an extra inch between himself and the thing. He winced as the figure sprang up, but then, 2 feet off the ground, it simply vanished. The space where the figure had been remained a circle of nothing for a moment, before an unsuspecting player in Shinshioka armor stepped into it and merged it back into the flow of eager crowds. A second later, Seiki found his hand on the hilt of his dagger and forced himself to let go. Ipe had looked up from his letter.
What is it?
I don't know. I've been seeing this face everywhere, said Seiki as he tried to recall when he had first noticed it.
A mask.
Ipe put down his brush.
A what?
Seiki let out a slight laugh at his inexplicable, disproportionate dread.
It's a real, thing, like, you know, someone with a geisha mask,
he guessed, again secretly chiding himself for the fact that it looked nothing like a geisha.
Oh, right, you've mentioned it before. A player? NPC?
Seiki sucked on his teeth.
I don't know. More like a ghost? It's never close enough for a label to pop up, and it just stands somewhere and looks at me, and then it disappears.
An idea occurred to him.
Oh, so maybe it's part of the unlabeled quest chain?
As unconvincing as that was, attributing it to part of game design he did not quite understand made him feel somewhat better.
No.
Ipe's expression turned dead serious.
I'm sorry, but that's just your Ichikea girlfriend stalking you.
In that case, I guess we should invite her up?
Definitely, since you've bought enough kakigori to feed the whole city.
Ipe gestured to the side of the room lined with bowls of shaved ice. A third of them were cherry-flavored, the rest Seiki had just picked at random, including something called shirokuma, which Mami, the kakigori shop girl, had said was exclusive to the festival week. Now that he looked at them again, Seiki had to agree the amount was ridiculous.
Yeah, their flyer got me,
he said with a sigh. It was only after he had made his purchase that he realized the time-limited ice bowls were double the normal price.
Their gold dump strategy is working, said Ipe.
For sure, said Seiki.
Luckily, the desserts only started really melting once someone dug a spoon in, so at least the room was not in imminent danger of overflowing with sticky sugar water.
So this masked stalker is out there?
Said Ipe, returning to the subject.
It's gone now, and I'm very sure I'm not hallucinating.
Wait, what if it's really a ghost?
No, not that kind of ghost, but a game ghost.
Seiki rushed to his storage box and crouched down to rummage for an item.
Maybe this thing is cursed.
The object in his hand, slick, black, unlabeled, which the society called a shadow seal, was disturbingly cold to the touch. Without warning, it suddenly sent an unpleasant shiver down his body, and Seiki grimaced and set it down on the floor.
It was only after we got it that I started seeing this masked thing. So maybe it's related. Maybe it has something to do with a disgruntled spirit and the cursed item attracts it.
Ipe looked a little doubtful.
So you're saying there's now a ghost coming after you?
Before Seiki could answer, three knocks sounded on the door. Seiki and Ipe exchanged a quick glance. The timing was a little too perfect, and a second of silence followed before the samurai shouted tentatively,
"Come in, Fuyu-chan!"
There was another brief moment of stillness.
It's me, came Yamura's voice.
Seiki laughed, somehow inexplicably relieved.
You're on the guest list. The door should open.
The wooden door rattled.
It won't open. It slides. Okay, I know it slides, but no, that's not it.
That was indeed a little surprising. There were two main ways to access another player's private territory. The first was to be in the same group as the instance owner. The second was to be on the territory's guest list. Ipe had earlier shown Seiki how to create one, and the list now hung on the wall next to the entrance with eight names on it. Seiki glanced at the list again to check if he had somehow misspelled Yamura's name.
I'm sure it's correct, he said as he opened the door.
Yamura of the Honor Warriors, level 17, was curiously, not in his usual various Shinshioka Ryoshi armor set, but in a long gray robe that barely fit him.
Hey, yeah, it was just stuck.
The Ryoshi took a step forward only to frown.
Okay, and now it says I don't have permission to enter. What the hell?
Ipe leaned over to look through the doorway.
You can't be in a group.
Group?
Yamura blinked.
Oh, right, okay. Can you invite Shota? No, wait, you're using a list. Here, I'll do it.
Yamura has asked for your permission to add Shota of the Honor Warriors to your temporary territory guest list. Unlike public territories, private territory guest lists were closed lists, which meant they allowed access to only specified players but did not automatically give them permission to invite other players in. Seiki had once asked his friends why guest lists for clan territories, like the White Crane Hall one Kiku had put him on, did not have the same security measures in place. Ipe's answer was that clan territories were designed to promote intrigue in the first place, and unsecure public guest lists simply made it easy for anyone to start an invasion. Seiki poked his head out to look down the short corridor. Yamura's mystery friend, of course, was nowhere to be seen.
Oh, Shota's not here, said Yamura, since it's a secret meeting and all, so I told him to wait at the temple.
The explanation shed no light on the matter.
Can't you just leave the group? Said Seiki.
Ipe leaned over again.
And who's Shota, if you don't mind me asking?
My clanmate. He's cool. An IRL friend, you know. From school,
Yamura added.
And seriously, I can't leave the group right now. We were doing a quest, and I don't know if I would lose all my progress.
Ipe looked at him.
Don't tell me you're actually doing a festival quest. Why else would I be wearing this stupid monk robe? Man, it's so stupid how you have to put it on to go into the temple and the palace to turn in this quest or they kick you out. Now they want me to sweep the temple grounds to prepare for some stupid Rogami ceremony.
Rogami ceremony? Said Seiki.
The Ryoshi grimaced.
I know. But come on, it's not like the Rogami is actually getting anything from the quests. Isn't it just like some sort of a skin?
Ipe had indeed said that the clan only benefited from short-term boosts, and the rest of it, including the ubiquitous flags and NPCs swooning over the Rogami clan, was simply cosmetic. Seiki had been wondering if he was missing out on the festival experience by not actively taking up quests, but then again, the idea of sweeping temple grounds for a Rogami ceremony did not sound like something he would ever want to do. Yamura shrugged.
Plus, you get festival tokens. I've got like 10 now. The Yoko quiver is kind of badass, you know.
Ipe laughed.
Only 190 more tokens? Good luck.
Yeah, and 6 days to go.
The Ryoshi was perfectly serious.
So if I get 30 a day, I'll make it in time.
If Seiki remembered correctly from the full guide to the festival he had bought earlier from the society, the Yoko set was a set of gear you could collect during the festival week. It was available across all classes, and every piece had the same stats as the equivalent standard Shinshioka first issue weapon.
For samurai and ronin, there was the yoko's sword, which was exactly the same as the hikari, but which glowed golden instead of white. There was also the yoko dagger, priced at 90 tokens, which Seiki was somehow casually considering. The stats were not better than his kohagane at the present, but yoko equipment scaled with player level, and so it might come in handy in the near future. Yamura shrugged.
Or even if I don't make it, I can do that feast thing at the end. Okay, come on, Seiki. Let's get this loot split over with so I can go finish this quest and get a few more tokens.
Ipe shook his head in amusement.
Just leave the group, Yamura. I'm sure you can catch up later with the quest. Leaving group would be even more suspicious. I already told him we got some awesome loot from a secret boss, and it would look dubious if I suddenly left the group.
He paused as he saw Ipe lifting an eyebrow.
Okay, I know. But he saw my XP jump, and I couldn't have lied to him and said nothing happened, all right? And I only told him there was a secret boss that we found, and then, well, the Kano Castle was trying to steal our loot, but we totally kicked his ass, and then there was this treasure scroll.
He trailed off.
But I didn't tell him what the treasure scroll was.
Ipe let out a muffled sigh, then his expression turned grim.
You know, Yamura, there was a rumor since Beta that if a part of the world is about to crash from overload, a world boss appears. It's a thing of fire and darkness that one-shots everyone and sends you to a random spirit shrine anywhere in the world. It has happened only once, early in Beta, and no one was sure how it got triggered, but the leading theory is that it's to ease the processing load from having too many players in one place.
Yamura frowned.
Okay.
Ipe continued.
Tomorrow we'll get to prove the theory when 10,000 honor warriors swarm the Renkan Mountain to look for this secret treasure cave. Maybe that will be your great contribution to the Shinshioka Scientific Society.
Seiki hid a smile. I don't think 10,000's enough. We should also put up a group recruitment sign in front of the palace. Yamura's eyes widened.
Okay, Shota's really cool, and this is definitely not getting out, he protested. And it's not 10,000. We only have about 3.
Laughing, Seiki accepted the pending prompt. You have added Shota of the Honor Warriors to your temporary territory guest list. Yamura blinked.
Oh, thanks.
Seiki made way for the Ryoshi. On the guest list by the door, the additional name slowly faded in. The lack of realism was a little surprising, but at least it was more convenient than having to find a brush and ink to write down Shota's name. Ipe groaned.
Seiki, one day I swear you're gonna let the Kano Castle in yourself just because they got themselves on Yamura's friend list. Hey, I know Shota IRL, said the Ryoshi as he sat down beside the loot pile, and I'm not going to be friends with some stupid Kano Castle.
I guess if someone's checking loot logs, they're probably gonna know anyway, Seiki told Ipe as he closed the door. I don't think the game is designed for people to keep things secret. I mean, with public logs and everything. The samurai let out a sigh.
This time, I actually asked my friend to wipe our logs as a precaution. I wiped your Shussebora scale piece and Kentaro's tailoring scroll.
The comment took Seiki by surprise. He had heard it took quite a few favors to do something of that sort, and he never thought they would ever have the need to.
Why? Fumiyama already knows who we are, and there's no way to wipe personal kill logs.
It had happened out the West Gate, where all combat activities were recorded in public military logs. He was sure Ipe knew that.
It's not the Kano Castle I'm worried about, the samurai said. I wanted everything else wiped too, but then it would have cost me a kidney. But at least the rest is generic enough to have been from a good war event.
If you call this generic, then generic is good enough for me. Yamura was looking through the loot.
Especially this one.
Something slammed heavily against the door, sending vibrations across the tatami floor, just as the wind chime clinked again. Following a small grunt, the door slid open, revealing a slightly dazed Mairin, level 15. The kitsune looked thoughtful as she rubbed her elbow.
I thought that being on the guest list meant my dash would work coming through the door.
It slides, said Yamura.
Yeah, of course it slides. No, I'm testing to see how you can break into someone else's instance,
said the kitsune before a bright smile lit up her face.
I just switched out my enhance and now my dash goes through more walls. It actually went through the Social Guild's spirit sealed panel earlier.
Seiki was not sure what exactly that meant. Several classes had abilities that allowed them to go through different types of barriers. The kitsune dash and the obake fade usually allowed you to pass through any kind of wall a focused strike could break, so he guessed this enhancement she was talking about was to power up that particular utility.
That's different, Ipe said. Sealed panels are for defense in clan territory PvP,
Territory boundaries are unbreachable because, well, they're not exactly a physical thing.
Myrin nodded.
But the Kano ninja breached our instance last night.
I'm sure it has something to do with the duplicate treasure poem that he had on him, said Seiki.
It was still the best theory he and Ipe had at the moment, after much discussion earlier that afternoon.
It was definitely a hack,
said Yamura, who was now admiring the Ryoshi enhancement scroll that promised him something he had called ghost arrows on his rapid shots.
I know. It's some rich people item duplicating hack, like a duplicate key.
For all we know, that might be intentional, said Ipe.
Maybe they're duplicate treasure poems and they all give access to the same instance. Not that I've ever heard of such a thing, but maybe that's how they designed it to encourage even more PvP. But since the drop rate of the poems is so low and the solve rate is even lower, the chance of you ever going into the same instance at the same time as another person is so low that it basically never happens.
He shrugged.
And maybe Kano Castle figured that out and took advantage of it.
Yeah, said Seiki. It would explain the whole thing with Renshiro's outlaws, too. They just get these poems into people's hands and they walk in to steal the loot once the instance is cleared.
But the paper behaved exactly like Kiku's treasure poem,
said Myrin.
There was definitely some freaky quantum physics stuff going on, remember?
Seiki could not argue with that. Both copies of the treasure poem looked identical and faded exactly at the same time. Also, when Myrin had torn off the corner of one, a tear had also appeared on the other one.
Think about it, said the kitsune. How would that make sense lore-wise? Why would there be two items in spooky entanglement in ancient Japan? It was definitely fishy on a meta level.
It was a hack, Yamura insisted. If anyone knows, besides Kano Castle, it would be the Society, right? Said Seiki.
Ipe looked doubtful.
Now you'll also have the Society crawling over the Renkan Mountain looking for this dragon cave of yours.
Myrin blinked.
What do you mean by also?
Ipe chuckled.
Ask Yamura.
Why, Yamura? And...
The kitsune blinked as she just noticed the extra name on the territory list.
Who is Shota?
My friend, said Yamura.
And why was your friend invited?
He's not, explained Seiki. I added him so Yamura could come in.
We were in the middle of a quest, explained Yamura. I couldn't leave group.
We're trying to summon a world boss, explained Ipe. Tomorrow, out the west gate.
Yamura shot him a glare while the kitsune girl looked absolutely confused for a moment. Shaking her head, Myrin decided to give up on getting to the bottom of the matter.
Anyway, Koharu can't come, since she's got something to do with her Kato club, and she says she wants one of the Obake scrolls if possible. Oh, and here, Seiki.
She retrieved a box wrapped in green cloth from her inventory and held it out to him.
Kiku said to give this to you.
The container was about the size of a holiday chocolate box wrapped in fine green cloth and was surprisingly light. Seiki resisted the urge to shake it in case it was full of delicate food items.
You have received hand-wrapped parcel, container. Open to see what's inside.
From the white cranes,
Myrin explained.
And are they going to show up?
Ipe checked his golden watch.
They're 10 minutes late already.
Kiku said the clan has decided to do some clan quests for the festival,
the kitsune said.
Something about shogun contributions? Not sure what that means. You know, we're like the only ones not doing festival things. Although I already did the one where you swap around the boxes. That was kind of fun.
See?
Yamura turned to Ipe.
See what?
Asked Myrin.
Ipe apparently decided to move on. So the White Cranes want to postpone the meeting?
Myrin nodded toward the parcel in Seiki's hand.
Kiku said the box would explain everything.
Hope this isn't some RP crap they do, said Yamura. If they wanted to do it later, they could have written way before this, and I would have finished the temple quest by now.
Seiki crouched down and set the box on the floor. It was delicately wrapped, and the graceful knots came off easily. The box itself was a simple, polished black wood box. Seiki lifted the lid. On top of a silky red cloth was a folded piece of fine calligraphy paper. It was labeled Handwritten Letter, crafted by Sayahime of the White Crane Order. The letter contained more text than he had expected, and neat rows of characters filled almost the entire piece of paper. His friends were looking at him expectantly, and so Seiki read it aloud.
Seiki-san, I, on behalf of the White Crane Order, officially express our intention to forfeit the rights to any of the treasures from last night's encounter. It is part of the clan's code of conduct that any member whose actions result in a positive outcome of an event that is otherwise lost is entitled to all rewards from said event, despite prior agreements.
We have always considered you as part of our clan and have recorded your contributions in preserving our clan's honor against ill-meaning parties, which will be counted toward your promotion merits should you ever decide to make that relationship official. We wish you a pleasant week during the festival, and let us know if you wish to join us for any of our clan activities. Kiku can provide you the full schedule. Seiki looked up in disbelief at the end of the very verbose paragraph. Does it mean what I think it means? Ipe let out an amused breath. Yes, it means we are still interested in recruiting you, and so here are some more bribes. Not that I'm complaining, of course. Me neither, said Yamura. Now that's what I call reasonable. I take it this is mine, right? He was already pocketing the Ryoshi enhancement scroll. And we should just split the gold five ways.
Okay, wait a minute, said Mairin. I still think we should give Kiku one of the Obake scrolls. I'll let Koharu choose which one she wants.
They've already said they don't want it. We don't want to offend their, RP etiquette, said Yamura.
And look, we can sell these for at least 100 gold each.
Ipe scratched his chin in contemplation.
You know, if you think about it another way, by forfeiting the loot, the White Cranes keep their hands somewhat clean in the Kano Castle kill.
The samurai gestured toward the 1,000 gold they had gotten from Fumiya.
What do you mean? Said Seiki.
What if the Kano Castle sends them a message and asks for it back?
Said Ipe seriously before adding,
politely. Say something like, it has come to our attention that you possess a part of our funds that has been accidentally misplaced.
What? Said Yamura.
Why the hell would they do that? That would be totally lame.
Ipe smiled.
Don't you know bullies always ask politely for your lunch money first? Then it's your fault for saying no.
Oh, said Seiki. It gives them a reason to start a clan war.
But the spoils are rightfully ours, cried Yamura. They tried to kill us first.
Well, your lunch money is also rightfully yours, said Ipe before concluding.
So, by not having any part in the loot share, the White Cranes are sending Kano Castle a message that they don't want to fight.
Mairin wrinkled her nose.
Oh, come on, they're just being generous. Kiku said it was Seiki's instance, after all, and she wouldn't have found the treasure if it hadn't been for us. Plus, Kentaro's gonna make them magical red headbands or something once he figures out how to do that. And not to mention that this isn't international politics. You want to start a siege, you just schedule a clan event for it. No need to have reasons.
To some people, politics itself is the game, unfortunately, said Ipe. Okay, wait, there's more.
Seiki interrupted the debate and continued to read.
We have not made sufficient amendment to what happened during the misunderstanding the last time we had the honor of having you as guest in our clan hall. To express the depth of our regret, we have enclosed these gifts.
Gifts? Said Seiki in surprise, before discovering the piece of fine red silky cloth that he thought lined the bottom of the box, in fact, hid another layer of items. Lifting the silk separator, he revealed three identical small envelopes made of oil parchment, neatly laid out to slightly overlap one another in a fan shape. A notification flashed as soon as his finger touched them. You have received auspicious sealed card, times 3. Seiki had seen enough war cards to recognize what they were. He turned to Ipe.
I didn't know war cards were tradable.
To his surprise, Ipe was staring at the items.
They're not,
the samurai finally managed hoarsely before letting out a deep exhale.
Oh, God,
he shook his head.
This is insane.
What's the big deal?
Mairin grabbed one of the cards to study, flipping it around in her hand.
Don't you get these cards all the time from your war runs?
Are these guaranteed jades? Seiki guessed.
A guaranteed full upgrade sounded amazing, but still, he had a feeling that three extra jade cards would not have caused his friend to look as if he was going to faint.
No, said Ipe. They're exactly the same as the normal sealed cards you get.
So yeah, what's the big deal? Asked Yamura.
The Shogun's insignia right there,
Ipe said, pointing to the bottom edge where a five-petaled yellow flower symbol appeared to be stamped.
That's the only difference.
He looked at Seiki.
These were beta gifts.
It took Seiki a moment to understand his friend's meaning. Beta gifts were special limited edition items given to beta players at the end of the test as an incentive to get them to sign up for the official launch of the game. Since it had been a long time since then, most of the cards would have been torn open and used by the time players unlocked war games, meaning that at this stage it was unlikely that there were still a lot of these cards lying around unopened. Seiki finally understood.
They're worth more sealed.
The value of the cards did not lie in the items themselves, but their rarity. Ipe nodded.
There were different reward packages you could choose from, said the samurai.
and some of the lower tiers included one of these. One. So it's not like you could get a bunch of them at once.
Told you they're generous, said Mairin.
It's a gesture, said Ipe.
Yamura frowned.
Of what?
As if answering his question, the tiny metal clapper clinked against the glass bowl as the wind chime alerted them to another message, and another pigeon flew in, this time for Seiki. He held his breath as he recognized the handwriting even before his brain could comprehend the sender's name.
Fuyu of Ichikeya, 1 minute ago. Doesn't Fuyu-chan always suggest the best gifts?
Letting out a groan whose meaning was unclear even to himself, Seiki handed the post message to Ipe.
Of course your girlfriend is mixed up in this, said the samurai.
He and Ipe had only started war games last week, and while it was no big secret, the fact that Fuyu already knew about this and had managed to procure the cards for the White Crane Order meant that Ichikeya also had vested interest in them.
It's a gesture to say that we're still watching you, said Seiki.
How could she know? Said Yamura.
You just keep an eye on the loot log, said Ipe.
Mairin frowned.
What does she want from you?
Again, another pigeon fluttered in, and the group exchanged apprehensive glances. Seiki grimaced as he grabbed it.
Fuyu of Ichikeya, 1 minute ago.
Now, once you're equipped with the cards, you might want to know that Fuyu-chan happens to have something called a potion of divine luck as well. Ask your friend what it is, Seiki-san. Imagine 3 lucky pops for your 3 cards, simply for 5 minutes of your time. I know you're interested.
Oh, God!
Ipe's reaction was even beyond what Seiki had expected.
So that's her real play? The potion upgrades anything upgradable to max.
We can do without 3 more jade cards, right? Said Seiki.
No, that's not even... Oh, God!
Ipe buried his head in his hands.
This is just ridiculous!
Okay, we're not gonna fall for this again, said Seiki. Still, he could not help asking, how much is this luck potion worth anyway? Ipe let out a long exhale.
The divine luck potion was also a beta gift. And all these things I got, you know, the real-world pocket watch and the jade and the set of trade skill charms, all that was tier 3, said the samurai. The divine luck potion was from tier 1. And yes, for that, in accordance with the traditional Japanese numbering system, smaller numbers are better. Tier 1 was top grade.
Oh, was all Seiki could say. Yamura's jaw dropped.
Okay, sorry, man, but for something like this, you've gotta go.
Even Ipe could not argue, and Seiki really wondered how strong his resolve against this was going to be after all.
Oh, come on, said Mairin. It's gonna be a trap again.
But it's a tier 1 luck potion, whatever that means, said Yamura weakly.
You are completely hopeless,
Mairin laughed.
Fortunately, while you guys were considering getting conned again, this arrived.
She held up a fresh post message, which must have been delivered when the rest of them were too absorbed in Fuyu's offer. Her eyes sparkled in excitement.
Kentaro's got it. It's magical red headbands for everyone.
Chapter 2.
Being right in the middle of the Pacchi Festival was a vastly different experience from observing it from a high window, although what surprised Seiki was that it was nowhere as daunting as he had first imagined. The streets, packed as they seemed from afar, had an almost organized flow to their natural pace. Fast traffic rushed through in the middle, while slower crowds gathered on both sides to admire the new goods the street stalls had to offer. Extra space had been allocated between the stalls, and so players could squeeze themselves in to make a purchase without getting run over. The NPC festival goers, Seiki soon noticed, never actually paused to buy anything, and after some observation, he came to the conclusion that they were there to set the pace of the traffic and make sure that meanderers got off the middle of the road, with an unobtrusive nudge here and there to keep people moving. Riding in such a crammed space, of course, was out of the question. Seiki had no doubt Fubuki would protest going through Trade Street in its current state, especially in tight crowds and so close to sparklers and street food grills. As he and his friends made their slow journey towards South City, he amused himself with people watching. Slightly ahead of them, someone called Kisao of the Storm Traders, level 26, was trying to lead his gigantic armored dark bay stallion through the crowd. He did not have much success, and the mount eventually made its unhappiness known by backtracking against the lead, almost kicking over a stall table and causing the nearby NPC merchant to yell at its helpless owner. The man eventually got the message that riding was not allowed and dismissed the poor beast, looking a bit lost.
Why do we have to go all the way to his clan hall again? Yamura grunted.
Then he grunted again as a group of low-level players rushed past him, a collection of 2 men and 3 women in starter gear. Seiki followed the new players with his gaze and could not help chuckling when he saw that their destination was boasting premium sake, rare flavors, 50% discount.
Look at this traffic. It's impossible.
The Ryoshi sighed as another NPC in a bright blue kimono of a shop hand nearly crashed into him.
Shota's gonna kill me. I swear it's getting more crowded by the minute. Don't tell me it's gonna be like this all the way through South City.
I don't mind it, said Seiki. He could not imagine being in such an unpredictable crowd again in real life, and now he was finding it strangely entertaining, even as an NPC carrying a sack overflowing with yam rudely pushed past him.
Well, you're too easy to please. You even like that shoes-off dungeon, said Yamura.
It's a good dungeon, said Mairin.
Yeah, for you, because they all turn out to be kitsune at the end. Anyway, wouldn't it be easier for Kentaro to come to us?
The kitsune was not listening, as she was busy entertaining herself with reading clan names she had never seen out loud.
Guindorin of the Kingdom of Girideon?
Mairin frowned as she inspected a tall girl who looked oddly out of place with her ankle-length murky yellow dress. Her weapon of choice appeared to be a frilly umbrella, which a quick inspect showed to have been altered from a longsword. Despite the outlandish appearance, the player was level 29, so Seiki had no doubt she had a fairly good idea what she was doing. Mairin did not look convinced.
Jeez, isn't she in the wrong game? Where did these people come from?
She suddenly burst into giggles.
Oh look, there's someone called Goto of the wrong side of the bed.
The man in question was in a casual mismatch of armor pieces and was carrying a strange long pole for a weapon, and Seiki was surprised he could not immediately guess the man's class.
People are coming in from the East Gate, said Ipe. Lots more freedom out there, and people get, well, creative.
Not always the good kind of creative, said Yamura.
There's only one kind of creative, said Mairin.
The festival had attracted more players from outside the capital city, as evident by quite a few unfamiliar clan names, plus a few armor sets Seiki had never seen before. Inspecting them was a fascinating attraction in itself. A smallish girl in front of him who had stopped at a potion stall, Miura of the East Front Villa, level 26, stood out from the crowd with several pieces of blue-green gear, all marked with the word Fuhara, which seemed to have at least +4 speed on every piece at the expense of both attack and defense. Also rushing about in large numbers were very new players below level 10, who looked as if they had just stepped out of South City for the first time, seemingly unaware of the potential danger of being in a PvP zone. Combat had not been disabled for the festival, but at least more guards were present, the only ones still on horses, overseeing the traffic with their usual stern expression. Seiki wondered if the heightened security was needed. City brawls only ever happened when players were bored, and bored was the last word he would use to describe anyone around him at the moment. Yamura continued.
According to some law of fluid dynamics, 1 person instead of 4 will get across the city way faster. Like how water goes fast in smaller tubes or something.
Ipe chuckled.
That's not the kind of dynamics you're looking for. But to answer your question, there's no way the society's going to let a unique disappear into a private territory.
Assuming he has the unique,
Mairin turned to say, looking a little doubtful. Kentaro had not specified in his post how exactly he was going to make the mysterious headbands, except that he now could.
He's gotta have it, said Ipe. That's the only way the recipe is possible. I have no idea how he managed that so quickly.
I know. Maybe he robbed the society and now he's hiding, like, in his clan territory, said Yamura.
That's why we have to go to him.
Mairin laughed.
Kentaro robbing someone? Not in a million years.
Who knows? The Ryoshi shrugged. The less you look like a thief, the better one you are. No one ever suspects a Hoshi.
Seiki grimaced as he was suddenly reminded of an innocent-looking level 9 Hoshi who had the appearance of being bullied by a high-level player.
Especially if your name is Akari, he muttered under his breath.
His friends did not hear him. Mairin was giggling.
Okay, Yamura, why don't you try to recruit Kentaro for your new clan, too? I'm sure you guys can do with an extra thief.
Before Yamura could say anything in retaliation, the kitsune exclaimed,
Ooh!
And rushed to a nearby stall where she grabbed a square teapot made of blue and white porcelain.
I swear I have this exact same pot at home. And I mean exact. What are the chances?
Yamura sighed.
At this rate, we'll never get anywhere.
As curious as he was about the mysterious headband recipe, Seiki could not deny enjoying the sights and sounds of the event. He watched in amusement as the kitsune tried to pay for the item with gold but was told she needed festival tokens. Seiki himself had earlier stopped at a stall selling territory upgrades, having spotted a black tea table set that would be a perfect replacement for the one that came with his Furuhashi South room. It was called a simple chabudai, and offered +8 health regeneration benefit for the owner of the room for half an hour if you spent at least 10 minutes in the room. Unfortunately, it went for a small amount of festival tokens he did not currently have.
It seems we're in severe need of festival tokens, said Myrin, coming to the same secret conclusion Seiki had made just a few moments ago.
Ipe laughed.
You can go sweep temple lawns with Yamura all you like later. But...
he frowned before nodding towards something in the street ahead.
Let's get out of here before we're caught in that parade.
Seiki had unconsciously picked up the sound of approaching drums and wind instruments, and now, after he turned his full attention to them, he guessed they were coming from one of those hourly parades that had been going by his window all afternoon. There was no direct view from where he and his friends were, as Trade Street was not visible behind the closest row of festival stalls, but the crowd around them was starting to stir in reaction to the incoming spectacle as they moved to get a better view. Having watched parades go by several times now, Seiki knew well that traffic usually came to a standstill in such an occasion. The paraders often stopped to do short dance sequences along the way, and getting through those crowds once it happened was impossible.
Okay, let's take this next right.
He pointed ahead to a small alley that he had first discovered when exiting the East City Bandits' underground territory.
It's a longer route, but we avoid all main roads. It puts you near the South City Post.
Seiki almost ran into a slender girl in yellow as soon as he led his friend to the shortcut. The festival volunteer, level unknown, did not appear to mind. Instead, she smiled brightly and thrust something into his hand.
Remember to drop by, Ronin-san,
she said almost too loudly for being so close. Seiki glanced at the piece of paper. It was labeled a Hanabi shop flyer. The header had colorful splashes of paint all over it, and underneath was a neatly printed list of items.
Festival sparklers. Toy. One festival token. Pack of 8 sparklers. Requires a flint or a fire source to light. Bamboo tube. 10 festival tokens. Combine this with at least 1 pack of black powder and 1 pack of stars to create your own fireworks. Has a 3% chance to attract the attention of the majestic white dragon during the last night of the festival. 3 slots. Black powder. 10 festival tokens. Combine this with a bamboo tube and at least 1 pack of stars to create your own fireworks. Adds a 2% chance to attract the attention of the majestic white dragon during the last night of the festival. 20-foot range. Takes 1 slot in a bamboo tube. Common white stars. 5 festival tokens. Combine this with a bamboo tube and at least 1 tube of black powder to create your own fireworks. Adds a 6% chance to attract the attention of the majestic white dragon during the last night of the festival. Takes 1 slot in a bamboo tube. Other fireworks ingredients may be collected from various sources during the festival. Seiki looked up at her, not quite sure what it meant. He had heard of the Night of the White Dragon before, and he knew it was one of the festival events, but with so many of them, and some with incredibly long titles, he was losing track of which was which. The approaching parade was drawing closer, and Seiki tucked the flyer in his inventory.
Thanks. I'll look at it later.
The NPC girl winked.
There are rumors of rare kinds of fireworks stars with amazing effects. Who knows? You might get a gift from the White Dragon.
Her eyes widened dramatically. When an NPC was that excited about something, it usually meant people had better pay attention.
Why would I want to make fireworks again? And this White Dragon...
World Boss, said Ipe, as if it was common knowledge. Now let's get out of here.
World Boss? Seiki repeated.
Ipe looked surprised.
You know what happens at the end of the festival before the patch goes live, right?
You get automatically logged out, and if you log in, it's all... dark?
The samurai laughed.
For a game that prides itself in never being down for maintenance, it's guaranteed to be more impressive than that. You can still log in during the update, but they phase you somewhere else for a bit. Like an alternate reality?
Asked Myrin.
No, more like... that building.
Ipe turned around to point at something across Trade Street. Just visible around the corner, further away in the distance on the main street, was a 6-storied structure made of dark wood, now covered from top to bottom with festival flags.
That's called the Lord Shogun's Banquet Tower?
Seiki searched his memory. He had passed by the building many times, and since it appeared to be permanently locked, he had always guessed it had something to do with inner palace favors.
Yeah, said Ipe. Our dear Lord Shogun is afraid you won't be celebrating properly, so he forces everyone to attend his 5-hour-long banquet. They lock you in there until the update is over.
Oh, so basically a fancy prison.
Myrin giggled. Slightly better, I would say, since you have access to unlimited food and drink, said Ipe. The better you do with the festival, the higher floor you can unlock at the end, and the better the quality of the consumables they give you. Nothing else really works, though. But anyway, instead of an update progress bar, you get to watch the white dragon fly around in the sky out the window. The moment he lands in the city, the world comes back on and you can leave the building. And straight into a world boss? Said Seiki. Yeah.
Seiki looked at his friend.
I don't know what you're talking about. The festival's awesome.
Ipe laughed.
The Rogami fan club's right over there.
Maybe the dragon will be yellow and black this time. Like, you have to kill a Rogami dragon?
Myrin guessed.
You don't kill the white dragon, Ojo-san.
The festival volunteer piped up in disapproval.
You attract his attention, and when you've proven your strength and determination, you can present an offering, and he rewards you back manifold.
Attract his attention with the fireworks?
Seiki wondered if it was going to be a public attempt. Perhaps the more fireworks players launched, the faster they could start the encounter.
Yes.
The girl nodded, then she gave them a broad smile.
If you or your party manages to fully get his attention, the white dragon might even grant you a private audience and set for you your own series of challenges.
Ipe stared at her for a moment.
Oh.
He sounded surprised.
Okay, I see. You're saying we can make it our own instance? That's definitely new.
Whether the guess was correct or not, the NPC said nothing to contradict it and gave them a wink.
So don't forget to explore. Better materials for firework rockets exist elsewhere all around the world during the festival. Yep. So now we need even more festival tokens, said Myrin.
Ipe chuckled.
All right. I guess I'll do Rogami Temple Lawn for private boss instance.
The samurai sounded almost serious as he nodded toward the main street, where the procession had caught up with them, the drumbeats thundering in rhythm, unsynchronized just enough to sound practiced but still amateurish.
Or, I heard there's a quest where you join one of these, costume and all, and how many tokens you get at the end depends on how well you...
His sentence cut short, Ipe jumped back just in time to narrowly avoid a projectile shooting straight through the group. The arrow, gleaming black, thudded into a woodpile on the nearest stall. The startled, scrawny, middle-aged stallminder let out a cry. Before anyone could make sense of what was happening, Myrin burst into her fox form, perhaps to sharpen her sense of hearing. A second later, a hail of projectiles followed. 4 or 5 more arrows whisked through the crowd, and one struck an unfortunate NPC festival goer, level 16, in the chest. Yamura let out a curse as the man fell right in front of him. The shots were coming from the direction of Trade Street. Spinning around, Seiki drew his kohagane to upslash more incoming arrows. The wind effect knocked a few of them onto the ground by his feet. One clanked noisily against his dagger blade, sending a chill up his arms as he fought to hold on to the weapon. Seiki drew a sharp breath. The force of the impact was much stronger than he had expected.
This must be some shooter!
At first, he thought this was a daring move by one of the clans that wanted them dead, but he quickly realized that the arrows were not aimed specifically at him and his friends. The crowd had already erupted into confused motion, with NPCs letting out panicked cries as they fled. Ipe's eyes lit up.
This is some shooter, all right!
The arrows gleamed black, and beneath them, their wavering shadows exuded a strange purple mist.
Demons!
Ipe grinned, his hand switching out his jade steel for the light-infused hikari. Around them, the crowd had descended into chaos. As stallminders started to flee, confused players drew weapons, some mistaking the commotion for a city brawl and trying to defend themselves from fellow citizens.
Hey, that wasn't me, you idiot!
Someone yelled angrily from ahead of them.
It's demons! A demonic clan ambush! Shouted a Shinshioka NPC guard. Get away from the parade!
More black arrows shot through the group, and Seiki finally spotted the enemies. One of the stalls had fallen over, creating a gap that offered a glimpse of Trade Street. In the middle of the procession performers, some of the drummers were tearing off their bright red parade costume, revealing their full black armor and gleaming blades.
Take cover!
Yelled another voice of authority from the corner of the street. The mounted Shinshioka patrol, level 35, raised his arm and from the middle of his hand, fast-moving white mist burst into a sphere around him. You are now under the protection of Ward of Light. The spell prevents you from losing more than 25% of your health every 3 seconds.
Engaging members of the demonic clan in combat will cancel this effect. 19 seconds remaining. Seiki felt a slightly cooling sensation on his skin.
I see. This makes it optional.
6 or 7 Shinshioka patrols in the area moved in to intercept the demons, giving people who did not want to participate some time to run out of range, and the area was quickly clearing out. In the middle of Trade Street, among the wreckage of colorful festival stalls, some players decided to fight back. A high-level samurai was charging the group of demons on his horse, his longsword shining bright silver as he unleashed the samurai's signature move, Mounted Strike. Arrows flew into the mix from a few ryoshi who had positioned themselves to the side.
Should we?
Seiki turned to his friends. Ipe had already drawn his sword.
This is going to be a PvE brawl for once, he said, sounding rather amused.
In a puff of white smoke, Mairin appeared in her human form, having returned from her scouting loop.
Okay, so about 30 demons. Pretty high level. So we're doing this?
Of course!
Yamura let loose several arrows at a demonic swordsman that was engaged in combat with the nearest Shinshioka guard.
I bet you get at least a few tokens for, like, no effort.
Alrighty! Tokens!
Mairin grinned. A moment later, she was gone again. Seiki watched the white fox dash toward the middle of the crowd.
Shouldn't she stay close and try to heal us or something?
Said Yamura. Only a portion of the drummers turned out to be demons in disguise, but they were destroying the rest of the unfortunate NPC performers with alarming efficiency. The Shinshioka guards did not have much success trying their best to fend them off. Even the Shinshioka patrol who had cast the shield earlier had been dragged off his horse by 2 demons, and a 3rd demon gleefully leapt in and plunged its dark blade into the man's chest, letting out a long, inhuman howl of triumph as the guard went still. Seiki winced and drew his sword, and the group moved closer to the action against the fleeing crowd. The enemies were high-leveled, as Mairin had reported, and the closest ones were all marked demonic attackers, level 30. They passed a few players below level 10 hiding in the shadows behind one of the upturned stalls, 2 men and a young woman who were peering out at the scene with an expression both fascinated and horrified.
It's gonna start when the last guard dies,
Ipe turned to tell the new players as they made their way around wreckage toward Trade Street.
The patrols are here to buy you some time to decide, so if you want to get out, do it before then.
Just then, a riderless Shinshioka patrol's horse crashed into a stall right beside the crouching players, a black gleaming demon blade stuck in its side. The new player's eyes went wide and they quickly scrambled to their feet and ran.
That way, not down the main street,
shouted Ipe after them, pointing to a smaller alley. The area was soon clearing of people who had decided not to engage, leaving about 70 players in the vicinity. The patrols were now overwhelmed, and the demons started to look for more victims. The nearest Shinshioka patrol collapsed, and the demonic attacker, level 30, he had been fighting, suddenly turned around. Its eyes gleamed as it spotted Seiki and his friends. Like most of its kind, the demon was man-shaped, but with a deformed, slightly elongated face. Its weapon, a long blade, seemed to have been fused to its arm and was dripping with fresh blood. Its red glowing eyes widened in delight at new targets, and the demon charged toward him with a snarl.
Level 30? Cried Yamura, leaping back out of instinct. Isn't that a bit much for a public event?
Ipe, at the front of the group, readied his sword to parry an incoming attack, grimacing as he anticipated a complete energy drain.
Hit it back if you can, he told Seiki.
Before the attacker reached them, a white glowing arrow shot from the side. Bright light exploded in a half-sphere in front of the approaching demon, sending it flying backward as if it had run into an electric fence. The demon landed in the wreck of an upturned stall, and Seiki took the chance to rush in with a sweeping blade. The move hit with a thick thud against the demon's black armor, but did no visible damage. The demonic attacker growled at him. Luckily, a level 24 samurai in a yellow festival-themed kimono stepped in and slashed it across the chest with her sword, drawing the demon's attention before it could retaliate.
Having engaged a member of the demonic clan, you are now no longer under the protection of Ward of Light. Behind him, he could hear Ipe and Yamura saying something about a ryoshi free slot, which must have been what the glowing arrow had been. Before he could rejoin them, a rider in Shinshioka armor cut him off. The gray mount leapt straight into a group of 3 demons, trampling one before bucking as another demon slashed a blade across its side. It really felt like a brawl. Seiki suddenly found himself lost in a sea of armor and blades and whistling projectiles. Looking once more for his friends, he spotted Ipe a bit further away, caught up in a group being attacked by 2 demons at once.
They're touch aggro, so just hit and run, shouted the samurai. And they probably one-shot, so be careful.
In the confused crowd, it was impossible to regroup. Seiki caught a glimpse of a white fox somewhere, dashing about in bursts of white smoke, too fast for the distracted demonic attackers to swipe at. Deciding that was probably a good strategy, Seiki located a group of three demons close together with their backs turned. He rushed in to unleash a vertical spike stun, buying other players time to unload some more damage on them. Then he spent all his energy landing a combination of slide, focus strike, and upslash on one of them, finding slight satisfaction in noticing that at least the combo managed to make a slight dent in the demon's health bar. He ran out before the demons had a chance to recover. That was about all he could do while he waited for his energy to recharge, but not much else seemed to be expected of the players. The demons, though max leveled, were outnumbered by the group 2-1, and soon most were lying on the ground in pools of dark blood. The one directly in front of Seiki let out an inhuman screech as a curved sword stabbed through its neck. Its killer was a man in golden brown armor and a ponytail, labeled Machida of the Sorono Wolves, level 27, who had a smug look on his face as he flicked off the purple blood from his blade. "Easy," said the man casually, perhaps noticing people looking at him. Seiki could not help chuckling while a girl beside him let out a quiet scoff. As more enemies fell, most of the players started to fill their missing health with potions or glance around idly for something else to do. "That's it?" said a man's voice, sounding a little disappointed. "No, this is it!" shouted someone in reply from the middle of the crowd.
"This is what?"
said the girl in dark gray who had scoffed earlier. A misty arrow still knocked in her bow, Raika of the Crafters Guild, level 21, crouched down beside the nearest dead demon as she reached out to loot it.
"Come on, one shadow essence?"
That was when Seiki noticed the demon's corpse was marked not lootable. "This isn't over yet," he told her. True enough, a shrill laugh cut through the air, followed by a gleeful shriek.
"Fools!"
A slim, shadowy figure had appeared on the top of the wreckage of a parade float. It was the same shape and size as the demonic attackers, but its face was hidden behind a snarling demon mask with red horns protruding from the top. Masks always interested Seiki now, but this one unfortunately looked nothing like the one he had been seeing. Raika sprang up to her feet and wiped her hand on her kimono.
"Unlootable. You know what this is?"
It took Seiki a second to realize she was talking to him.
No, he said.
Since the girl was from the Crafters Guild, Seiki wondered if she was an acquaintance of Kentaro's, although there was no point asking at the moment.
"Utter fools!"
The masked figure let out another laugh. It made an elaborate wave of its arms, and the demon attacker's corpses on the ground started to hiss. The crowd yelped in surprise, and for a moment, Seiki thought the demons were going to resurrect into undead enemies. That guess was completely off the mark. A split second later, the bodies exploded into dark, acidy dust. Disgusted cries went up all around, and several streams of confused abilities and arrows shot toward the masked demon on the wreckage. Seiki held his breath as the dust covered his skin with a sticky sensation. The air around him had gained a dim, slightly purplish hue, like he was looking through tinted shades.
"You are affected by the Curse of the Dying Shadows."
"Can't cleanse it!"
a Hoshi girl somewhere behind Seiki reported. Reika, the Crafter's Guild Ryoshi, made a face as she grabbed a potion from her pocket and downed it. Her grimace confirmed that it had no effect.
"You have walked right into my trap!"
The shadowy figure on top of the wrecked wooden float gestured its arms elaborately at its audience.
"You pitiful humans! You think you are safe within your city walls?"
"No, you constantly get one-shot by high-level pricks!"
shouted a man from somewhere to Seiki's right, earning a few chuckles. The demonic figure ignored the interruption.
"Do you think your sacred animals will keep our superior forces at bay?"
"Skip!"
someone yelled from the other side of the procession float.
"Not a chance!"
screeched the masked demon, the timely response earning a few more laughs.
"Now that we've lured out Shinshioka's best, we'll pick you off one by one. The irony of being ripped to shreds by one of your own sacred animals."
"What sacred animals?"
asked someone else. No one had time to laugh at this one. With an ear-splitting crackle, the demon liquefied into a pillar of swirling dark mass. Long-reaching shadows exploded outward from it. Only when one of them touched down on the ground right in front of Seiki did he realize they were not shadows at all, but streams of black ooze. The closest stream solidified as Seiki jumped backward. A second later, he was staring at a gigantic arachnid leg.
The sky darkened above the group of players. Towering over them was a beast the size of a train carriage, with the lean body of a tiger, but with 8 spidery legs instead of feline limbs. From where Seiki was standing, its head showed at least 6 red glowing eyes on the side, and 1 protruding fang dripping with black venom. Dark smoke swirled around it as its skin hardened into thick, sharp scales. Kogumo, corrupted divine beast of the Westgate, level unknown. HP 520,000 of 520,000. Someone cursed from within the crowd.
And I thought this would be some easy tokens.
Seiki recognized this particular voice and could not help chuckling. It was Yamura's. Chapter 3.
More like repair bills!
Someone let out a yelp. The beast snapped into motion the moment it finished transforming. A strange low roar exploded from its throat, sounding like 1,000 wood planks being crushed at once. The Kogumo turned on the group, its thick multi-jointed legs immediately knocking several unprepared players off their feet. Seiki leapt back as one of the front legs struck out in his direction. Each of the monster's limbs were as thick as a young tree, with hooked claws near the sharp pointed end that could both cut and stab. The Kogumo did not hesitate to put them to good use. Its legs busily swept out, splattering blood as it moved through the group. The crowd ran around like schools of fish being chased by a predator, and Seiki tried his best to avoid getting run over by fleeing players or caught by the deadly clawed legs. The safest location seemed to be directly under the beast's torso. Many players quickly figured this out and moved in to take advantage of the spot, but its belly was higher than players could reach standing on the ground, and its hard, jagged exoskeleton warded off most of the Ryoshi's normal arrows. The worst seemed to be the jaws. The beast's mouth was wide enough to clamp over 3 players at once, and its fangs were sharp enough to impale the victim straight through. Only explosive shots aimed directly at the mouth seemed to deter it from snapping at the crowd, and most of the players fled out of the way as soon as they found themselves directly in front of the beast. As Seiki repositioned himself, a notification flashed in his mind. Stay within the shadow cast by the summoned demonic beast to avoid taking damage. In front of him, a sweeping leg caught an unfortunate level 16 samurai in the stomach, its claws hooking into his armor and raising him off his feet. The man grunted as he struggled to slice the hard talons off to free himself. Being shaken from side to side, his aim missed and the blade clanked uselessly against the exoskeleton, doing very little damage from the awkward angle. With a yell, he finally raised his sword and stabbed at the closest joint, and the leg suddenly flung him away. The man landed in a pile of collapsed wall 20 feet from his original position, 2/3 of his health missing.
"Run back!"
a girl shouted from the crowd. The samurai blinked.
"What?"
Then his eyes widened as black dust around his body started to hiss.
"Run back here!"
yelled the girl again. With a curse, the samurai scrambled to his feet, but it was too late. Black mist fizzed around him, and a moment later he collapsed, his health completely drained. Making a quick mental note not to make the same mistake, Seiki tried a sweeping blade as one leg crashed down dangerously close to him. If the move's knockback effect worked at all, it was too subtle to see, and the impact felt as if he was hitting a stone pillar with a kitchen knife. Looming above the group, the beast let out another deafening roar. Its 8 legs suddenly stomped down at once, sending a violent tremor through the ground and kicking up a thick cloud of dust. Seiki covered his nose and mouth as a few players beside him started coughing.
"It's jumping! Run!"
a man shouted. Whatever that meant, the crowd stirred in reaction. The beast suddenly leapt up high and propelled itself forward. As if someone had unexpectedly yanked away a beach umbrella, the sky opened above Seiki, nearly blinding him with sudden sunlight. The oily substance on his skin started to hiss. You are exposed to the sun. Curse of Shadow applies, taking up to 25% of your existing health every 3 seconds. Get back into the shadow of the demonic beast to avoid damage. An icy black mist formed around him. Seiki grunted and ran forward, following other players who seemed to know what they were doing. His armor was barely effective against the burning sensation on his body, and the curse started to eat away at his health. Gritting his teeth, Seiki suddenly felt a touch of gentle cold that lessened the sizzling sensation all over his body.
"Thanks for the soothe!"
he shouted to the unseen healer. Ahead of him, the monster landed on one of the shop walls, collapsing the storefront into a pile of rubble, bringing down with it a few unfortunate players who had misjudged its trajectory. Seiki sprinted forward toward the Kogumo, and as soon as he was in range, the scorch on his skin vanished. Breathing a sigh of relief, Seiki now understood what this mechanic was for.
None of the ranged classes could afford to run to the safe distance that they usually relied on, making it important for melee and utility classes to block as many attacks as possible. Swinging his hikari at the nearest leg, he hit it away with sweeping blade before it could disperse a pair of ryoshi. The knockback effect was much more effective when the leg was raised off the ground. Around him, the group was doing their best to damage the beast. Ryoshi's high-level explosive shot burst against the monster's belly, chipping some of its protective exoskeleton, while another samurai let out a battle shout, filling Seiki and the people in the near vicinity with an influx of extra strength. Seiki looked around for his friends. He caught a glimpse of Ipe somewhere, but the monster's rapid attacks were keeping most of his attention. Another spidery leg stabbed out, and a man in front of Seiki rushed out to parry. He was perhaps a little under-geared, and the impact sent him sprawling into a nearby ryoshi. With a cry, both of them lost their footing and landed on top of each other. Seiki burst forward with a swerving slide and grabbed both men by their arm and collar just as the beast lifted its leg to stab down directly at them. The ryoshi cleared the range of the attack. The swordsman was less lucky, and the bladed tip of the monster leg slashed across his back. The rest of his fate was unknown, as Seiki was forced to reposition himself once again when more spider legs rammed down around him.
"Seiki!"
cried a familiar voice from the ryoshi he had managed to save. Satoru, level 18. One of the self-proclaimed outlaws scrambled to his feet and grinned.
"Hey, didn't expect to see you here, and thanks for that."
Seiki grinned back in delight.
"It's been a while."
Satoru had quickly recovered from the near miss and was already readying his bow. His arrow magically became three and he scattered rapid shots at the beast's belly.
"So you haven't been out the East Gate much?"
"No, I've been catching up on war games."
"Makes sense, considering your friend."
Satoru turned and shouted,
"Hey, Ichan! Look who's here!"
Seiki followed his gaze and spotted the ninja girl. Itsuki, level 19, was now dressed in tight-fitting purple and white leather, with the lower half of her face hidden behind a leather mask.
"Who's this?"
Itsuki playfully lifted her brow.
"Is it your new... Ow! Hey, hey!"
she cursed as the corrupted beast almost sliced her in half with the claws at the end of its leg. Leaping out of the way, she retaliated with a hail of thrown daggers. Even Itsuki's attacks did not appear to be doing much damage, but at least the monster's health was decreasing from each minuscule contribution, slow but steady enough.
"Is Renshiro here?"
Seiki split his attention between avoiding the demonic beast and scanning the crowd for the outlaw ronin. Backing away to get out of range of the nearest arachnid leg, he repositioned himself at a decently safe spot.
"I sent him a few messages a while ago."
"No, he's not on, and he would probably flip if he found out we're doing a festival at Chieve."
Itsuki laughed as she turned to her outlaw friend.
"You know, we can just tell Ren-san we're visiting Seiki in the city."
Seiki was not sure what she meant by that.
"So, did he get any of my messages?"
"Ren-san now has his pigeons disabled at the post office."
The ninja girl tossed out another attack. Her shurikens hit with an unusual acidy hiss, but Seiki was in no mind to take extra note. She made a face.
"Yeah, I know. It's a real pain."
"Why?"
"Well, 'cause tracking paranoia..." "Okay, it's moving again!"
Itsuki cried out as the beast jumped once more, this time 20 feet diagonally ahead. It obliterated several abandoned festival stalls as it landed. Once again, the sudden sunlight burnt hot on his skin, activating the curse and vaporizing about a tenth of his health. Satoru and Itsuki were already running, and Seiki rushed ahead to keep in range of the monster. Next to him, a level 14 ryoshi, who did not have health to spare, collapsed onto the ground amid thick black hissing smoke.
"Anyway, how can I talk to Renshiro?"
Seiki asked as soon as he reached the safety within the shadow of the beast.
"I need to ask him about..."
He paused as he realized that it was probably not wise to be shouting out a conspiracy theory about the most powerful clan in the game in the middle of a public event.
It's really important."
Satoru grinned.
"Come with us after this. We're just dipping in to work on the achieves."
"And easy loot,"
Itsuki chimed in. Seiki dodged gigantic legs crashing down as the beast suddenly spun. People screamed while the Kogomo caught several players in its jaws, shook them a few times before flinging their limp bodies aside. The monster was around half health when Seiki managed another few energyless strikes on its legs, most of which glanced off without doing much damage to its hard exoskeleton. He diverted half his attention back to the conversation.
"I have something kinda important to do after this. How can I find you later?"
Itsuki was using shadow strikes to avoid the attacks, making her appear and disappear at will.
"Thanks to Ren-san, we're all off pigeons until after this Dish Mansion run."
She let out an annoyed scoff.
"Yeah, it's a real pain.
So actually, you can do us all a favor and tell him it's a stupid idea. It's like he wants to live in the Dark Ages or something.
Despite not knowing why anyone would ever wish to disable post pigeons, this at least explained why his messages to both Renshiro and Mia had gone unanswered. "We're camping out in Lower Haruzawa," said Satoru. "Come find us." Seiki tried to commit the unfamiliar place name to memory as he dodged another incoming attack.
"Do you have a minute after this?"
He did not get to hear Satoru's answer. The Kogumo spun, and Seiki suddenly found himself staring into a gaping jaw at least 6 feet across, flanked by multiple red glowing eyes all locked on him. All other thoughts drained from his mind, Seiki yelped as he pulled up his hikari to parry, almost out of instinct. He slammed energy through both his arms and down the length of the silver blade, blocking the descending fang right before it could pierce him right through. The ability activated in time, and the impact shook his whole body. A violent burst of force threw him to the side, squeezing air out of his lungs. Seiki had twisted the blade so as to have some control over the angle of the knockback, but there was no way to be precise. Landing on his side, he skidded several feet across the ground, taking down a few unfortunate players in his path. His arm guard warded off most of the damage, but he could still feel a patch of numbness across his right side as he came to a stop. Unsurprisingly, his energy had drained to zero. The bite would have been fatal. Uttering a quick apology, Seiki untangled himself from those he had crashed into. The Kogumo had managed to grab a few more people in its jaws, and Seiki ducked to avoid the lifeless bodies tossed his way, which thudded down around him like sacks of flour. He scrambled to his feet, only to realize he was not out of danger. The spidery legs had not let up their attacks, and one slammed down directly where he was. Hastily trading a fifth of his health for energy with blood rush, Seiki activated an ill-planned slide, wincing as more numbness spread through his back as the arachnid leg glanced off his armor. The move did save him, and when he managed to find his footing again, he noticed a glimmer of something golden on the ground in the midst of broken tiles and wood. At first glance, it looked like a tiny jade war card, but one that glowed in a rich hue of honey yellow. Before he could make out what the inscription said, an arrow shot at the tile, shattering it into golden dust. Satoru was standing a few feet away, grinning. His bow already had another arrow knocked in it, its tip glowing faint yellow.
"Power-ups,"
Satoru explained as he aimed his shot at the spider leg. The arrow unleashed an unusual burst of gold light as it found its mark. "A tile of vigor has been shattered. 10% of your maximum energy has been restored." The bout of energy was a welcomed surprise. It seemed that the boost was an area effect that benefited all players in range. A samurai girl nearby suddenly exclaimed,
"Nice!"
before turning her sweeping blade into a swerve cut at the last second, the extra energy allowing her to slice off a chunk of the protective shell on the nearest leg. Seiki gazed around the ground. Partially buried in the rubble near his feet was another tile. Slightly different from the first, this one glowed serene white and was labeled a tile of longevity. Copying what Satoru had done, he crouched down to hit it with Focus Strike. "Your Hikari's Focus Strike has absorbed the power of a tile of longevity. Unleash it with another Focus Strike." He needed no more instructions. Seiki spun around and stabbed his Hikari into the beast's exposed, throbbing flesh under its chipped armor. White light burst from the point of impact, sending a strangely warm sensation up his arm and through his body. "A tile of longevity has been shattered, restoring 50% of your maximum health and 10% of all other players within 10 feet of the target." In a pleasant flood of warmth, his health rebounded, just as the spider leg lifted off the ground. Seiki yanked back his sword before it slipped off his hand, but not quite fast enough. The leg swept, flinging Seiki through the air. He yelped, somehow managing to land on one foot and one knee, and he pushed energy through his slide in the opposite direction to stop the momentum.
"It's like Uno."
Seiki glanced up. Itsuki had appeared beside him, her eyes watching the monster.
"Sorry, what?"
They both had to scramble out of the way as the Kogumo stomped down with three legs, kicking up dust between them. Itsuki let loose a bout of shurikens at the ground, and Seiki saw that she was aiming for one of the hidden tiles. This one was rosy pink in color.
"Uno. You know, Uno," she said again. "As in not Japanese Uno?"
She tossed out more shurikens, exploding another tile with a red burst on the ground, causing a nearby samurai to grunt in frustration as she had beat him to it.
"You can stack,"
Itsuki giggled as she turned to Seiki to continue her flawed partial explanation of how it worked. She launched a hail of metal stars at a crack in the beast's exoskeleton on its stomach, which was dripping dark blood. Two rapid bursts of reddish light exploded in the wound. "A combined tile has been shattered. 5% of your maximum health has been restored.
All ability lockouts have been reduced by 1 second. All ability lockouts have been reduced by 2 seconds.
Like that, said Itsuki.
Seiki glanced at the beast's label again. The Kogumo's health was below a fifth now, with the damage ramped up from the boosts. With a sudden vicious roar, the beast started to sway from side to side, its 8 legs smashing, sweeping, striking in random directions. Melee players who had been running in to activate their power tiles bore the brunt of the increased attacks, and a few of them got crushed under the thrashing spider limbs.
It's going berserk! Cried a voice.
The attacks increased in both speed and viciousness, and one leg lashed out, sending 2 players flying. Seiki ran to the side, dropping low to slide under the 2 front legs as they suddenly swept inward. The claws whisked over his head, missing him by a foot. Other less fortunate players were now trapped between the legs and the beast's jaws. As they yelled out in alarm, someone frantically shouted,
"Stack brace, now!"
The Kogumo's bite closed on the group in a brutal collision of metal and fangs and panicked cries. Half the people dropped to the ground, either dead or too injured to move.
"This is the last stage!" someone yelled. "We need to burst!"
From the rear end of the Kogumo, a man was galloping in at full speed. The rider was level 29, clad in a formidable-looking set of metal-enforced black leather armor. His clan name was unfamiliar, but Seiki could spare no attention to read it, since his gaze was fully drawn to the black mount. The horse seemed to be running over fire, its hooves striking up fiery sparks whenever they hit the ground. Its jangling, bright, copper-colored tack seemed to be designed specially to match this effect. A spider leg shot out at the rider, and the man grabbed his dagger to block, easily stopping the leg in midair as if it had hit an invisible wall. Seiki could only guess that was a one-handed parry, which he had never witnessed before.
"Get in range!"
yelled the galloping samurai. He skillfully swerved around 2 more legs, then ducked low to avoid another, before straightening up once he cleared the beast's body. That kind of showing, coupled with the quality of his gear, gave him automatic authority, and players parted to make way for him. With half his face hidden behind a black helmet, the man lifted his sword, holding it high like a revolution flag. The long, straight blade radiated a fierce flame of gold and red and black.
"Come in now!" he shouted.
The samurai's mounted strike slashed across the beast's neck. A bright, multicolored explosion burst from the point of impact. A combined tile has been shattered. 10% of your maximum energy has been restored. 5% of your maximum energy has been restored. 5% of your maximum health has been restored. 5% of your maximum health has been restored. You have received an additional 2% chance to dodge in the next 10 seconds. You have received an additional 5% chance to dodge in the next 10 seconds. You have received an additional 2% chance to dodge in the next 10 seconds. All ability lockouts have been reduced by 1 second. All ability lockouts have been reduced by 1 second. 10% of your maximum energy has been restored. The notifications were too rapid to parse. The initial burst of buffs had given more people time to activate their power tiles, and like a chain reaction, they all activated on top of one another in rapid waves. Seiki nearly gasped as energy, health, and strange vigor coursed through his veins, putting everything at his disposal all at once. Rushing in with the rest of the now invigorated crowd, he stabbed the nearest leg, unleashing his combination of sliding focus strike and upslash, before swinging out his blade as another leg threatened to slam into him from behind. Around him, the players went into a hacking frenzy. With a constant influx of perks, Seiki freely spent all his resources. There was no need to plan. His lockout countdowns were dropping steadily by a few seconds at a time, constantly putting all his abilities within reach. A deafening crack broke his trance. To his right, one of the spider legs had collapsed. Glancing upward to catch the beast's label, he found its health bar fully depleted. Another leg snapped like a broken branch, and the beast started to topple. Seiki's eyes widened as he realized what was going to happen, and he ran, slid, ducked low, and pushed down all his energy to speed up as the Kogumo started to break apart right on top of him. His surroundings darkened. Another leg broke under the weight of the dead beast, and the monstrous torso crashed down, leaving barely any room left under its massive body. Seiki activated his second slide, aiming for the triangle of light in front of him, wondering if he would make it in time. On the ground, he noticed, almost too late, a gleaming black stone tile. Desperate for just about anything, Seiki stabbed the tile with a hasty focus strike as he shot past it. Then he did something he had never done before. He twisted his body so that he faced upward,
pushed energy down his sword arm to activate another focus strike, before forcing additional energy up his left arm and yanking his hikari to parry, just as the remains of the beast crashed down over him. A tile of protection has been shattered, giving you an extra 20% chance to dodge and 5% for all other players within 10 feet of the target for 8 seconds. An invisible force grabbed him from all different directions, and Seiki felt like a stray stone cast from a slingshot by an unskilled hand. Something icy scraped down the length of his leg, and after a confusing glimpse of complete darkness, he was suddenly in jarring sunlight. He hit the ground at a bad angle and slid to a numbing stop against something hard and crumbly. It took him a moment to catch his breath, wincing as he found himself hanging onto a sliver of health. As the world slowly faded back into focus, Seiki finally remembered where he was and what he had been doing. Having been so engrossed in the task, it was a little disconcerting to find himself in the middle of a wrecked trade street, but the feeling of being completely lost in the moment was a familiar one and something he welcomed. Unsure what had happened with his last two moves, he slowly looked up. Around him were broken debris from a familiar shop wall, some of which had collapsed over the lower half of his body. In the middle of the street, the Kogumo was now a massive black corpse on the ground, its broken legs sprawled in every direction. Its multiple eyes had shriveled and were silently giving off a strange, purplish fume. Around the monster, dead players, caught in the final round of ramped-up damage, started to automatically disperse into white smoke. They would presumably revive somewhere near, but Seiki was in no condition to find out at the moment. He scanned the crowd but could not locate any of his friends. A shadow loomed up beside him.
"You actually survived that?"
Seiki glanced up at the speaker, who turned out to be a tall swordsman in Shinshioka armor from a clan with a very long name that Seiki did not feel compelled to read.
"Barely," said Seiki,
then he coughed, at the moment realizing that one side of his lungs was probably not working. The man laughed.
"Could have just died and rezzed there, you know."
He gestured towards something else out of Seiki's field of vision that Seiki again did not bother to look at. The man then shrugged and picked something up from the ground before whistling to his horse. Seiki only now turned his attention to the notifications.
Kogumo, corrupted divine beast of the West Gate, slain. 1,744 XP gained. You are now free of the curse of dying shadows. Festival achievement earned. Keeper of the West Gate. 250 XP gained.
Not bad, I guess,
Seiki said out loud to himself, grimacing as the experience crept only a tiny bit closer to the next level. The revive point was apparently somewhere over at the end of the instance down the west side of Trade Street. Quite a few players, who had presumably died earlier in the last stage of the encounter, were walking back toward the carcass of the beast to take a better look, and light conversation was starting to pick up. Seiki struggled to free himself from the rubble. Considering the effort it took, he thought the man was perhaps right and it would have been easier to die and resurrect. It was a strange sight. Trade Street was thrashed almost beyond recognition. In front of the shattered shops, festival stalls had been demolished into piles of strangely colorful debris, with torn banners and flags and damaged goods visible among the broken bricks. From the edges of the instance, Shinshioka patrols and NPC festival volunteers were rushing in to clear away the damage. Somehow, the scene surprised him. No matter how big a brawl was, the city itself had never suffered beyond mild scratches on the walls, and that had always given the place a feeling of permanence. Seiki finally pushed himself up into a sitting position as he looked around for his friends, using his left hand that still had some feeling left to grab a health potion from his inventory. It turned out to be unnecessary as a second later, a wave of heal filled his health, warm, powerful, and almost honey-like. He turned around to thank the Hoshi, then broke into a relieved grin. Standing by the dead Kogumo was Mia, level 25, the outlaw Hoshi. In the same manner she never seemed to quite belong with the rest of her outlaw group, now she did not seem to belong in front of a backdrop of a deceased demonic monster. Her light green kimono was perfectly neat, her fan-shaped metal pin holding up her hair in a perfect short ponytail. She looked like someone who had come out to Shinshioka for tea and cake, not someone who had just been in combat with a giant spider.
"Thanks," said Seiki. "I've been hoping to see you."
Mia smiled.
"Nice to see you too, Seiki. Satoru told me you were around. So level 15 already. That's fast."
Thanks.
Seiki was not entirely sure what level he had been when he last saw her. Mia let out a little laugh.
"You really always give it everything you've got, don't you?"
She was most likely referring to the state of his armor, which had taken quite a few scrapes and had not finished mending itself.
Even in a casual event like this.
Seiki wondered what kind of event she would consider serious, but then he supposed being level 25 made a big difference on how she experienced the encounter. Before he could say anything else, he was interrupted by three refreshing bouts of the kitsune spirit mend.
Oh, you're already full, said Mairin.
The kitsune was making her way toward him, leaping lightly across a broken monster leg. Part of her white kimono was drenched in the monster's dark blood, which had yet to fade away, but she did not appear injured.
I had no idea where you were,
she said.
It was a bit crazy. And can you believe that even at the end, people still didn't realize you couldn't stand in the sun?
She shook her head, then noticed Mia and smiled.
Oh, hey, thanks for earlier. Awesome heals, and I didn't know you could boost the foxes like that. What level is that again? It's a Hoshi free slot, and my pleasure.
The outlaw Hoshi smiled from the corner of her mouth.
I practice with reckless people on a daily basis, so.
Her expression clouded over as she spotted something further away, and her eyes narrowed by a tiny bit in annoyance. The slight frown, however, lasted only for a second before her smile quickly returned.
The rest will unfortunately have to wait. See you around, you two.
Wait! Cried Seiki as Mia turned to leave. I really need to talk to Renshiro.
We'll find you,
Mia whispered almost inaudibly, one hand raised in an apologetic gesture. And then she was gone in a whisk of green kimono, disappearing behind the dead Kogomo before Seiki could ask her to repeat whatever place name Satoru had earlier indicated as the outlaw's current campground.
Haru, said Seiki, then he cursed. It's Haru something for sure.
Mairin was still looking in the direction of the Hoshi.
Renshiro? Oh, okay, she's one of your elusive outlaw friends.
Elusive is about right,
Seiki sighed. Did you happen to get her alternative post address or something when you were healing together? Mairin giggled, and after a second, Seiki realized it was not because of his freshly coined concept of healing together. Seiki's eyes widened.
No, it's not like that. I need to talk to Renshiro, and they apparently don't do post pigeons.
Her eyes still sparkling with amusement, the kitsune shook her head, and Seiki turned to look for the cause of Mia's hasty departure. Standing in a small group near the head of the dead Kogomo and conversing quietly among themselves were several high-level players. A man with a longsword, Hiroto of the Tamiya Tigers, level 26, and Manabu of the Kyosei Temple, level 28, and his clanmate Oshin of the Kyosei Temple, level 25. Plus two more players who were slightly out of range whose labels did not appear. None of them appeared to be looking their way, and Seiki could not possibly guess who or what Mia had tried to avoid.
Eita, said Ipe's voice from behind them. Kyoho archers.
At first, Seiki thought his friend was answering his question, but the samurai, walking to join him in Mairin, was apparently looking the other way down Trade Street, a thoughtful expression on his face. The object of Ipe's attention turned out to be a rider in black galloping in the direction of the east gate, his slim longsword strapped across his back.
That's a fire stepper?
Seiki had never seen one, but it was obvious what it was. The effect was much more pronounced than Fubuki's faint snowy effect around her hooves, and it was certainly drawing attention.
Nice horse, said Mairin. That's like Fubuki, right? But fire and not snow.
I think so, said Seiki.
Steppers were quite rare, and apart from the small efficiency boost in terms of energy, they were not that different from other standard horses, and so not a lot of people sought them out either.
Well, that's certainly a fashion statement,
Mairin laughed as she casually sent out spirit men to random people who happened to be in range, some of whom returned a smile or wave. She nodded at the rider.
So you know him, Ipe? Oh wait, there's Yamura. Hey, I sent my healing foxes your way, but I'm not sure if any of them got to you. Did you die?
She raised her voice. The Ryoshi was making his way toward the group from behind a circle of social guild players.
No. Almost, but luckily no. The monster missed. But I'm out of arrows again.
Did you see the foxes, though?
Said Mairin. Ipe's attention was still on the owner of the black fire stepper.
He was the guy who started the whole burst phase with his ridiculous stacking. That was six of them, I think. Did you see that?
He turned to ask Seiki.
Yeah, that turned the tide.
Ipe nodded.
I think we would have beaten it anyway, since you can infinitely run back from the revive point. But that flash...
He let out a chuckle.
Anyway, did any of you figure out how the stacking worked on those power tiles?
Seiki shook his head.
I got two of the power-up tiles, but not close together, and I used both of them straight away.
It was not as if he had any other option on the second one.
I got them to stack once, said Yamura, who had now reached the group and who was once again looking wistfully at his empty quiver. Not sure how. Maybe you have to hit them quick, like within 5 seconds?
Yeah, maybe, said Ipe, who was still watching the rider.
Oh, that guy, said Yamura. Okay, how do you get that mount? It would be a set with this firearm guard. Maybe I should start building a fire set.
The fire's the wrong shade, said Mairin.
To his surprise, Seiki found he was thinking the exact same thing. The fire under the horse's hooves was a warmer, gentler fireplace orange than the more vibrant reddish flames on Yamura's fire rat fur arm guard. The man had now turned Trade Street's slightly northward bend and disappeared from sight. Ipe shook his head in amusement.
Well, Kyoho archers of all people.
The clan name was unfamiliar, and Seiki failed to see the significance.
What about them?
Archers, said Ipe. The guy's a samurai. I didn't know the Kyoho archers accepted anyone outside the class.
What, it's a Ryoshi-only clan? Said Mairin. Isn't that kind of pointless?
Hey, said Yamura. You'll understand when you see what they do over there, said Ipe.
Mairin raised an eyebrow.
And what do they do over there?
Extreme sports, said Ipe. Allegedly.
What?
Said Mairin.
What? Said Yamura.
How?
I have no idea. You're the only one who can join them and find out.
The samurai chuckled as he bent down to pick up a small piece of black carapace that had broken off the kogumo.
But now it's time to claim our reward. Don't forget yours.
Oh, this is like that giant skeleton world, boss? Said Seiki as he picked up a random jagged piece from the ground and rose to his feet, wondering how many tokens it was worth. He looked at Ipe and grinned.
I'm really liking the festival now.
Surprisingly, Ipe had on a solemn expression.
This came just a bit too soon, said the samurai quietly, as if to himself. I was hoping that we'd be more ready for it, but then again, maybe you'll never be ready, and ready is now.
Ready for what? Asked Mairin.
The samurai shook his head, perhaps unwilling to speculate out loud, but Seiki suddenly understood. Perhaps what his friend had meant to get at was change. Things might not be as static and permanent as they appeared, and it was both exciting and terrifying. Ipe shrugged off his musing with a chuckle.
I guess as long as we get to fight demons, I'm good.
Chapter 4.
Even with the festival permeating every corner of Shinshioka, South City still managed to retain much of its original character, a kind of peaceful, tucked-away charm that made visitors unconsciously slow their pace. Vendor stalls were much sparser, and some smaller alleys remained for the most part unchanged by the event, save for a few decorative flags and posters. Seiki noted that the signs here spelled out instructions much more clearly, too, perhaps in consideration of the area's lower-level populace. One particular stall was advertising for help and openly promised one festival token for 15 minutes of your time, while another showed step-by-step illustration of how to put together a festival firework rocket. Being familiar with where the Crafters Guild was located, Mairin was leading them down South City's complicated back roads, and the short journey took them past old shops and slow-flowing canals and more weeping willows than Seiki remembered. What suddenly struck him was the age of South City's structures. The carvings on many of the stone bridges had worn away. Wooden shop signs seemed to have been painted over many times, leaving traces of their older version like shadowy ghosts from a distant past. Thinking back, Seiki realized he had skipped much of Shinshioka's starting zone. For the first time, he was convinced this part of the city was older than the rest, a native settlement, perhaps a farming village from which the remainder of the city eventually grew, and now South City looked on the festival with a kind of mild amusement, like an elderly grandparent watching a child indulge in present-time whims. He wondered if such history was intended as part of the design, or if it was just a product of his imagination trying to attribute meaning where he wished one existed. Glancing around, it seemed his friends were too engaged in discussing the festival to be in the mood for lore speculation, so Seiki simply promised himself he would come back to explore later. Their destination was a medium-sized estate surrounded by gray stone walls, whose crumbling base was covered in a thin layer of old lichen. The territory boundary was at the gate, and Mairin, who was on the clan's temporary guest list, added them all to her group to allow them access. The other side contained a lush garden which covered a single-story black-roofed wooden building. A stone path led them through the front yard, where large, healthy trees were allowed to grow to their full height, providing ample shade and a sanctuary for songbirds. Most of the trees were red and black pine,
but also at least one of each of the rarer trees, including the elusive cypress that was one of the most prized woods. This being the Crafters Guild, Seiki had a suspicion what they were for, but he could not imagine the clan simply letting members cut these down at will. The walk ended at the raised platform of the building, above which a large sign read, Heiwa Residence. This was the clan hall of the Crafters Guild, home of allegedly the best crafters Shinshioka had to offer, and this was where a certain Hoshi, now dressed in refined, silky gray, was waiting for them with a look of total disbelief on his face. Kentaro of the Crafters Guild, level 14, frowned after he had done a quick inspection of his guests.
Not to mention why it took you 40 minutes to get here. If you don't mind me asking, how did you all manage to get your brand new upgraded gear under 80% again?
Seiki saw him frown at the tear on his shoulder guard that still showed a visible scar. That must not have been the worst of it, since Kentaro's frown deepened when his gaze passed over Mairin.
Well, said the kitsune brightly, it was a nasty spider we ran into.
Kentaro suppressed a sigh.
Yes, but it was just last night when they were all perfectly maxed. If you keep... Oh my god, don't tell me you managed to lose your whole Sigahaya trimming!
He stared at Mairin's white silk kimono. Seiki only now noticed that it was missing at least a few inches off the right sleeve.
I had to slice it off with my dagger because it was stuck under the nasty spider, said the kitsune matter-of-factly, before adding in a sheepish voice, Sorry.
Kentaro looked horrified.
You cut it off? It doesn't come back in that case!
Mairin smiled.
I'll sell your charms for the rest of my life, promise.
She then added before Kentaro could say anything,
And we actually got something for killing that spider.
Yeah, I've got 14 tokens now.
Yamura grinned.
I tell you, this is going to be easier than you think.
Trading in their monster piece had turned out to be simple enough, and rather intuitive considering the setting. NPC guard stations doubled as prize booths, where players could redeem their rewards. To add to the flavor, they all had a chance at drawing a bamboo lot out of a tube, and depending on the color at the end of the stick, the guards would hand them a loot bag tied with a string of the same color. Seiki's blue-stringed bag yielded 4 gold and 38 silver, 7 festival tokens, 2 honor points, and 2 more event items. Festival Yakitori Skewer, level 4, food, times 3. Increases the attack range of your next 3 moves by 3%. Red Pokemono Stars. Combine this with a bamboo tube and at least 1 tube of black powder to create your own fireworks. Adds 20% damage to your attacks for those under the trajectory of the rocket and an 8% chance to attract the attention of the majestic white dragon during the last night of the festival. Takes 1 slot in a bamboo tube. His friends received similarly random festival loot, with minor variations in the amount of gold and festival tokens. Mairin received no gold but a wooden frog toy, treasure, that would be worth 2 favors when turned in at the palace. All in all, it was decently lucrative for the amount of time required, and even when Seiki knew full well that the lucky draw was exactly the same as receiving automatic random loot, he could not deny it had some thrills to it, especially when the guards told him whoever drew a gold stick was entitled to the grand prize.
What's the grand prize?
Mairin had asked. The NPC guard then showed her a curious item called Zoisachi Scroll, which would add 2 extra enhancement slots to any piece of gear or weapon that had fewer than that. He also added that 10 festival tokens gave you 1 chance with the bamboo sticks, and Seiki suddenly understood why everyone was out doing quests.
So it's not like we were just lagging,
Mairin concluded.
There are much easier ways to get your tokens, you know, said Kentaro after patiently listening to their account of the Kogumo encounter and subsequent prizes. Which involves high-level crafting,
Ipe guessed from the Hoshi's slightly smug look. Kentaro smiled.
Exactly.
Ipe looked at him.
But now we're going to do some even higher level crafting.
It was a question. A rare, mischievous spark lit up in the Hoshi's eyes.
Yes.
The prudence and the obscurity of the exchange paid off. At that moment, running out of the front door was Ichika of the Crafters Guild, level 13, a young girl in a bright blue patterned kimono with an armful of scrolls. She glanced at the group before smiling at Kentaro.
Hey, Kenchan, I've heard. Congrats.
It was not surprising that maxing out a trade skill was a big deal for such a clan. Kentaro returned an amicable nod and said something about trading recipes. The girl laughed.
Talk to me when you max calligraphy,
she turned to say before dashing off onto the stone path. Kentaro turned his attention back to his friends and gestured towards the entrance of the building. The look of pride on his face reminded Seiki of a particular bandit when he was introducing his beloved hidden clan hall.
although it was arguable that the Crafters Guild was more hidden by the general lack of interest in trade skills.
Shall we?
Shoes off, seriously? Said Yamura as he noticed the wooden rack in front of the clan hall. Seiki was not surprised that the clan required everyone to remove their shoes before entering. After all, a clan that valued high-level crafted footwear would never miss out on the chance to put them on display. On the wooden shoe rack were about 10 pairs of assorted crafted clogs, sandals, woven leather shoes, as well as Western-style military boots. One delicate-looking pair of pink silk sandals turned out to have a whopping plus 62 defense, and Seiki had no doubt there were powerful enchantments on them. He stepped through the doorway into a small reception area, used as storage for umbrellas, and was greeted by an unexpected notification. You have entered a customized zone within the Crafters Guild Heiwa Residence. Custom combat rules apply. Post status, disabled. PvP status, disabled.
Okay, and post disabled? Said Yamura in disbelief. What's with you people?
Mairin giggled.
The crafters guard their secret recipes very strictly. They think there might be a bunch of Ryoshi spies hiding outside, ready to spray their pigeons with rapid shots and steal their recipe for some long-winded pottery bowl no one really cares about.
Kentaro smiled.
You forget that someone once started a siege over a pottery scroll. But no, you can always step outside into the garden to send and receive mail.
Why?
Said Ipe.
Bad cell reception inside?
No, you don't want to be distracted when you're handling things like Toeri silk or Komisaki clay. The Hoshi obviously did not expect any of them to understand what he meant, since he went on to explain.
If you see how much highly sought-after crafters get pestered by potential customers, you'll agree it's a good idea not to have hordes of pigeons constantly pecking on your window.
From the reception area, there was another open doorway that led into the main building. The interior of the Crafters Guild was spacious but simple, and entirely covered with firm, high-quality tatami flooring. The main hall was divided by a painted folding panel into the front and back. The former served as a lobby, with several low tables surrounded by different types of cushions and legless floor chairs. Behind the divider was a library, with wooden pigeonhole shelves lining all three walls. The two wings flanking the main hall were raised about half a foot higher and were divided into smaller rooms with shoji doors all facing inward. Overall, everything was perfectly symmetrical, orderly, and empty. If any of the 10 clan members who had left their impressive footwear out the front door was inside, Seiki could not guess where they could possibly be.
Wow, this place is dead, said Mairin. Where is everybody?
Most likely off fighting one of your demonic spiders.
Kentaro chuckled as he led them to the right-hand wing. Seiki followed, letting his gaze linger on the shelves of scrolls at the back of the hall for a moment to gauge their number. His quick tally came up to at least 1,000, and he wondered if there were that many different crafting recipes in the game to start with. Their destination was the room nearest to the front entrance. It was the size of a meeting room and looked like one, with nothing in it but a wooden cabinet against one wall, two vertical landscape paintings for decoration, and a square floor table in the middle. The cushions were stacked in a neat pile against the side of the cabinet, and Kentaro grabbed them and casually set them around the table. He pointed to the one on the other side of the table, facing the door.
Leave that seat at the far end for me, please, and let's keep the door area clear.
As they sat down, the reason for the raised platform became apparent. There was a recess under the table with plenty of legroom, which Yamura seemed quite happy to discover.
So you've got the unique? Said Ipe as soon as Kentaro slid the door shut.
Naturally. Kentaro smiled as he made his way to his seat.
It will be delivered very soon. We have a special relationship with the society, you know. By we, I mean the Crafters Guild.
Seiki blinked.
It's that easy? Well, there are slight caveats, of course, Kentaro clarified, although he did not seem that concerned. But first, the raw materials. Here, one strip of coarse cotton cloth and one bottle of red dye.
He retrieved the items out of his sleeve, then dropped them casually onto his lap before producing another item.
Sumi ink.
Kentaro placed a black stick about the size of his thumb on the table in front of him.
And scarlet ink? And peafowl stone ink.
He put down similar items, red and green ink sticks with golden engravings, next to the original black.
And these, of course.
Several ceramic ink dishes followed, and a calligraphy brush. Yamura frowned.
Why do we need brushes?
Kentaro gave him a look that Seiki could not quite interpret.
Obviously, because...
The door sliding open interrupted him. It was a young woman in a bright yellow kimono, labeled Irumi of the Crafters Guild. Level 24.
Her hair was held up by a large half-circle decorative pin, and cradled in her arm was a lacquered wooden box. She seemed startled by the number of people in the room.
Oh, well.
She flashed Kentaro a smile as she recovered.
I've never seen such supportive friends, or sumi-e enthusiasts. And hello, Seiki.
This is Irumi, our clan secretary, said Kentaro. She keeps all our recipe lists organized.
The woman looked incredibly familiar, and Seiki searched his memory for a clue. As she carefully set down the box on the table, he finally remembered where he had seen her before, or at least other versions of her.
I'm Irumi,
said the young woman. Despite her businesslike tone, there was a hint of laughter in her eyes.
If you're looking for either one of my six sisters, I'm not her.
Seiki opened his mouth, but was not quite sure how to argue.
But you're all the same person.
Septuplets.
Irumi nodded earnestly.
Very rare, I know.
Oh, I see,
said Seiki, suddenly realizing something that perhaps should have been obvious a long time ago. Now at least one thing was clear. One of Irumi's so-called sisters was Ikumi of the Shinshioka Scientific Society, who was one of the higher-ranking members of the clan.
That's the connection. That's why...
Perhaps he had meant to say that was why the society knew so much, especially if one of their members was also a member of everything else, but he could see no easy way to explain. Kentaro raised an eyebrow.
What connection? She's part of this group of...
Septuplets, said Irumi.
Septuplets, Seiki gave in. So, they're almost identical and their names all start with an I. Like Irumi, Ikumi.
He was not quite sure what the other ones were called and only recalled that she was a bard or performer of some sort.
That's why she's everywhere.
Irumi stifled a laugh and Kentaro glanced from Seiki to his Crafters Guild clanmate, looking completely lost.
Excuse me? Who?
Mairin's jaw dropped.
Okay, you're that musician person we saw out in Manuka Village.
Manaka, said Ipe.
Irumi grinned.
Oh yes, that would be Ibumi, one of my sisters. She loves travel. I've got six of them, you know. It's quite annoying sometimes.
She turned to look at Seiki when she said it, and he was not sure if she was actively breaking character for a joke.
But let's not waste our time, shall we?
She knelt down on the nearest seat and carefully placed the box she was carrying on the table.
The society needs this back for their exhibit, or Kazuki is going to kill me. And I've got so many festival quests to assign. If anyone would actually bother checking in for once for their clan quests and not get caught up in their shopping spree.
I did mine, said Kentaro. And like I've said, I'm happy to do a few extra ones.
Irumi nodded.
Yes, you did. You're always very reliable. Thanks for that.
She then smiled.
So this thing, as promised.
To refer to it as a thing was an understatement, and everyone unconsciously held their breath as she removed the lid from the lacquered box. The weapon was wrapped in another layer of yellowish leather, and she gently lifted it, wrapping included, with both hands, and set it down in the middle of the table.
The needle of the weaving princess,
Irumi announced, with the same unconscious reverence everyone used when handling unique weapons. Carefully but skillfully, she undid the protective wrap. Sitting on the yellow leather was a very slim blade, 3/4 of a foot, perfectly straight, double-edged, and gleaming white silver. It came without a sheath. The hilt was intricately woven over with very dark blue silk threads, which ended in a tiny decorative cloth amulet hanging off the end, a white bird with its wings spread against a background of blue. Silence fell as she slid it across the table toward Kentaro, and Seiki took the chance to inspect it. Orihime no Hari, unique. +2 attack, +3 speed. Effect, grants 2 temporary levels in all trade skills already unlocked by the user as long as the user has the weapon equipped. Enchantment, virtue of economy. Crafters may occasionally use less materials than the recipe calls for. Enchantment, High Chamberlain Igaki's Noble Blessing, doubles the chance of proccing Tenjonoma-grade crafted items. Enchantment, Meditative Calm. Adds an additional 10% precision rate for all trade skills. Additional charm slot, Niwatori Plume. Adds an additional 10% chance of proccing the starting quest of an undiscovered recipe. It must have been the first time Kentaro had seen it, and the Hoshi studied it for a moment before removing his secondary weapon, a small fan, from his obi and placing it on the floor beside.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.